Yeah, buddies. Sonics don't believe in Christmas, but it's coming. You can't stop it. It's the Bennington Show on what I'm told by science is a Thursday. I'm Ron Bennington. There's Jen Bennington.
Hello.
And I'm Ron Bennington. Gail Bennington off today. She's in Philadelphia for a funeral, but like a trooper, hung in there last night and did the big comedy 101, and what a night it was.
Oh, it was amazing.
What a night it was.
Ridiculous, man.
All kinds of shocking guests showing up and really being funny.
Huge ovations.
East Side Dave made the scene. Pat Dixon and then Anthony Cumia all hanging out last night for Comedy 101 at the Stand. And for being a room that size, I don't know why I was screaming so much that I blew my voice out. I was just really over the top. Like, yes!
It was an intense show.
So much fucking fun!
Well, it was. It was an intense fucking show.
I know, but, you know, level out, dude. Talk like a person.
I'm all for the screaming and fun.
I can't say to people, I mean, obviously this show, well, the tickets were gone within minutes. I think it was 3.5 minutes and the tickets were gone, which the compound guys couldn't understand at all.
Really?
And they were trying to plug, you know, like, should I plug? No, it's gone. No,
don't.
How would it be gone if they don't know we're coming? Because you're not that big a deal, guys. I'm trying to tell you. It's the 101. But really, crazy. Crazy fun all the way around. And the comedians last night, I think it got progressively almost too good.
Yeah, like they had material, the open micers, that was getting laughs, which we're not used to.
And then at the end of the night, and I'm sure in the history of 101, this was the craziest the audience had ever gone for anyone. Sorry, Vito, but Big A, the insult comic...
He was strong.
He was edgy.
God,
he was in your face.
Topical.
And from what I understand, Jen, he's single.
Oh.
I've never met anybody that looked as much like a real-life cartoon character as Big A.
He's amazing.
He could honestly, without any animation, just walk into Bob's Burgers and then nobody would... There wouldn't be a single letter to the... to the studio at all about it. They would just believe it.
Oh, yeah, it's a Big A. He's always been here.
A Big A.
A Big A.
A Big A. Big A. Big A. Big A. Big A. But very, very funny night. Who was the guy that we were just all crazy about?
Oh, that was Chris?
I don't know. That was
Chris, yes.
The guy, he's... Something with his hands being like T-Rex arms.
Yeah.
And he comes in, he just grabs the mic, and he just takes over the stage. I mean, he's really, really good.
And, like, the arms were... He was quite good with them.
Yes, of course, because he lives with them every day, Chris. It's not like if we just did this to you.
But look, exactly. I was just, when I saw him work that mic, I was like, damn, this guy really is, really knows what he's doing.
In the meantime, you had fallen down twice... And he chipped a back tooth, which is almost impossible when you fall.
I don't know how that happened, but it did. I got to go to the dentist.
Whole gang was great last night from a producing point of view. You guys just ran with it. Jen, you were fantastic. Big Vito, fantastic. But I'm hearing from everybody. MVP, Nick at Night.
Nick at Night. Yeah. He's a sweet boy, and he's fantastic at a live gig.
He's an actual really good producer. He stays ahead of the puck. It was just great, man.
And he did the Thanksgiving show, and then he did this Comedy 101, and he's been fantastic in both.
Yeah.
He's the best.
In the meantime, I don't know what the hell you were up to.
Yeah, I kept almost falling down.
I saw you peeing in an aquarium. And it was at a pet store. Yeah. It wasn't even ours.
I said, aren't they look thirsty?
Jen, how long have you been with us now?
I started October 17th.
Okay, October 17th. She's already done multiple live shows, right? How many altogether so far? Like four,
oh
five?
Oh, my gosh.
You know, all the people coming through here. At any point, are you used to weirdness yet? Like, did it get weirder than you could even believe?
It's getting weirder and weirder as days go by, honestly.
Does it shock you that we look normal while that's happening?
A little bit.
Yeah.
I think everyone's just getting more and more comfortable with me, especially, you know, in the office, Chris and Vito.
They weren't comfortable with you before, you think?
I mean, I think they would just hold back a little bit, yeah. You know? Like, now they're just like, we don't care. They're really broing out in there.
Okay, so...
that's what you call broing out?
That's definitely a case for HR. Now, what about you? Are you as reserved as when you started here?
I've opened up a little bit.
Yeah.
They've made me more comfortable.
Because the fact that I follow your Snapchat, I know you're a little bit on the wild side. Way more than I thought. I thought this was a very reserved young lady.
Well, she was telling us about the Johnny football night at One Oak, which is like, that club is in Page Six every night, pretty much, for every celebrity goes there.
Yeah.
Now, how do you get to swing in there? Just for being hot chicks?
Pretty much. It was like a girl group, and one of my friends knew a promoter, and he just kind of let us in and got a little VIP table next to Johnny.
Unbelievable. Seriously, this, by the way, this is New York City.
It is.
Which is annoys the hell out of you.
There's so many dudes who are promoters.
Yeah.
And they just bring chicks in the clubs, and that's their job. That's it. That's all they do. They work, you know, three nights a week. And they're all dirtbags.
All right. The guy that we were talking about, that's Chris Crespo, and his Twitter shows him playing a sax. Let's retweet that if we can, so we can take a look at it. But he was kind of, in my opinion, the big star of the night before Big A came out. Really nice hands for Pat Dixon, Eastside Dave, and Anthony Cumia.
It was a compound media night. It was awesome. That place went fucking crazy.
Well, first of all, how weird that they all came down together. And then, like, here's the thing. So we're sold out forever. And then Keith comes, who nobody expected him.
No.
And he brings his entire staff.
Yeah, everyone, board ops, everybody.
Why wouldn't that have been requested early on?
I don't know, because I was in contact. I was, you know, telling everyone when they got to be there, you know, where they have to be. And I was like, I was being overly... I was giving too much information, probably, and no one ever said, you know, we need a plus whatever.
Now you know to ask.
Yeah.
Do you need any pluses? Exactly. Do you need a plus 40? So most of them were doing a standing room only gimmick, right?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Because that place was just packed out.
Yeah, it was fun, man. That was really fun. By the way, I'm going to be hosting the New Year's Eve, and luckily... the information I got wrong yesterday, I'm not doing four shows, I'm doing two shows, 8:30 and 12:30, but some major players going to be part of that show.
Jim Florentine, Janine Garofalo, Sherrod Small, Lori Kilmartin, and Joe DeRosa.
That's a gigantic show, and then a major superstar got floated by me last night as a possibility.
Really?
Major superstar.
Would I know him?
Yes. Yes, you would. And I know what you're thinking. Oh, that makes him black. Not necessarily. Not necessarily.
I thought of a black guy immediately. Because she knew him.
So tell me how people can get part of that New Year's Eve.
You go to thestandnyc.com, and as soon as you go there, the link has popped up. It's the first thing that you see on the page.
I know no one thinks about New Year's Eve until like a week from now. And then you panic that you got nowhere to go.
And you're calling
people,
what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing?
Yeah, what are we doing? We going to your house? We're just going to sit there and stand in your hallway and drink? New Year's Eve is actually kind of an annoying night to me.
Oh, it's ridiculous. Being in Manhattan for New Year's Eve, it's a shit show.
It's a shit show everywhere, though. Yeah. You've just never been anywhere but New York. But anywhere you go in the country, it's like crazy. But listen to that lineup of guests. Now, I don't think everybody's going to be at every show. So, I mean, you might want to check on that. I know I'm going to be with Florentine and DeRosa. I hear Janine. Sherrod, I just heard about. But I'm sure a lot of these guys are running around doing all kinds of clubs that same night. I'll be running around just doing one club and then going home.
Stationary.
Stationary, that's what I am.
That's fun,
stationary,
though.
Funny man.
Yeah, it's good. Thestandnyc.com. Just go to that website, and then the link's right there.
So, yeah, I'm doing the 8:30 and 10:30. And then when the 12:30 starts, I'll be home sleeping.
Not enjoying the concerts that go on television after the ball drops?
No, I'm not a big fan of that at all.
They're so terrible every year.
I'm really not that big a fan about New Year's Eve to begin with. You know what I mean?
Do you ever like the TV programming that night? Like, it's usually pretty bad. Despite, like, the count, you know, people loving the countdown or whatever.
What are you talking about?
Like, they always have, like, musicians on, like, it's a big concert, but it's never anyone I like or...
Well, they have, it's like the halftime shows, you have to say, look, this is for everybody, which means it doesn't really please anyone, but everybody has to know who they are. You have to have somebody who had the big hit of the year, and then you have to have someone, you know, comfortable enough that a little tiny kid and the grandma can know.
I remember last year they premiered a Taylor Swift video. That was the big thing for New Year's Eve.
That's when she was fingered in the ass by a shock jock DJ. That's what they're saying now. He posed for a picture, lower it down.
Okay.
I believe it was the middle finger.
Wow.
And then he was just using his finger a little bit. And she was too much of a lady to complain about it. But then as time went on, she was like, you know what? I'm not taking this anymore. I'm going to tell everybody.
Hey, I got fingered in the ass.
I got, what's the old shock thing? Remember the shocker?
Two in the stink, one in the
pink. All right, dude. I'm just saying, I'm looking for the term.
I think that's it. Yeah,
I don't want you to say that thing in front of our.
Don't call HR.
She should. She has every right to.
Don't.
And that looks like a cover-up. Stop putting your finger down. Put your goddamn finger down.
Oh, no, it's like this. It's
I'm going to switch you out with Vito.
Don't. Don't do that.
So anyway, that's what she did. Now, a friend of ours made TMZ today. Our good buddy Jay Moore. Second time this year, they're saying a divorce.
Oh, no.
I love Jay and Nikki, and I wish them both the best. But I have to say, I'm always impressed when somebody makes TMZ. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like the front page of TMZ. So, sorry for what's going on in your life, and I hope everything works out for the entire family. I couldn't say more nice things about them. But feel good that at least TMZ is interested.
Yeah.
You know?
That means everyone's doing well in a way.
In their own way, like it just means, it's just a reflection that your career is going good.
Yeah.
That's all.
Look, they're paying attention.
I remember when Florentine, when his divorce came up, and he made Page Six and TMZ. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, Florentine's doing great.
Right?
Like, it didn't even once occur to me that a family was breaking up. I'm just like, who's doing his PR?
Holy shit.
Who's doing his PR? A lot of people tweeted out this... brought down the house last night for Comedy 101. My abs hurt from laughing so hard. I just ran 8 blocks to the stand for fear I would miss Comedy 101. I'm sweating like the Trump cut.
Oh, thank you.
Look, when we make these announcements, jump on them early because these shows are unbelievable. I mean, they're funny to me and I'm in it. And I'm laughing.
It's ridiculous. It's just like a madhouse in there during Comedy 101.
These aren't compliments the way that you're saying. It's like a well-defined comedy show, not a madhouse.
I'm saying a madhouse of laughter.
I don't need that kind of a weirdness. It's like Bellevue, folks. It's like literally you checked into Bellevue.
I would buy a ticket to that.
Where were you all night, too? At one point, I tried to give you... any time I try to give him a sign for something, he does just the opposite. I do the tap of the wrist. Vito, you work in radio. What does a tap on the wrist mean?
I'm going to assume time.
Does it mean run at somebody with a water?
No, I'm going to say time. I'm going to stick with my answer.
I thought you gave me the miming, chugging like a glass.
That had happened before then.
Oh, God.
When nobody had water for me. So, luckily, Nick at Night came through like a trooper, just kept busting in with bottles. You know why? He's got producing in his blood. Chris, on the other hand, has blood in his urine.
It's really starting to hurt a lot.
What am I saying? That's more blood than urine. There was a couple of drops. Hey, what about when the kids started cooking up in the spoon? I really started to get carried away with it.
Oh, yeah, Daniel.
Well,
yeah, I was surprising.
What is everybody's name Daniel from that? Right, did you get the retweet on Chris?
Yeah, I'm grabbing it.
Why now? Oh, because I said it for the seventh time? Go to Bennington. And we didn't put it up. We didn't retweet.
It's
just typing away. It's not talking to me.
I have to get to the page first.
Page.
Oh, we haven't retweeted yet.
Yes, we have.
I'm going to refresh then.
I tweeted his Twitter account. It's in his profile pic. That's what you got to look for.
Okay.
Oh, God.
Okay.
Anyway, the point is this. It was a really fun night all the way around. Really, really good time. Now, Jed, are you making any big friends since you've been here? Who are your best friends since you came to SiriusXM?
As sad as it is, I think Vito might be because he knows the most about me.
First of all, that is sadder than sad.
It's really pathetic.
We spend a lot of time together.
Any of it for good? Now, have you made any friends outside of the team?
Oh, no, I haven't.
You haven't made any Shade 45 friends?
No.
Why? They don't say hi to you?
Oh, well, I mean, I've said hi to them, but, like, not friends, you know?
Right.
Friends is, like, it's a stronger bond.
But you don't even have, like, little conversations with them yet?
Yeah, mini conversations. Yeah,
all right, mini conversations, good place to start. Plus, they're all looking over their shoulder. They know when there's a new kid in town, like Glenn Fry used to worry about. Did you find it yet?
I haven't found it yet. Don't know why.
Bad producing?
Bad producing. Here we go.
Okay. It's fucking just... There he is playing the sax. Is he really playing that sax?
He's really playing that sax.
No, how do you know? You have as much information as me. We know he's holding his sax up to his mouth, but it's a steel picture.
It looks to me.
I know. We get what it looks, but instead of just saying that, we're going to have a conversation about it. By the way, somebody gave me, and this is Party Shots, Bob from Party Shots, and he gave me these things, which... You see that there? It just says the Interrobang on it. And yeah, it's really cool. And then he gave me some Christmas ornaments. Let me run over my coat. Chris, you plug something while I'm doing it.
Okay. Well, you can go to the Interrobang.com to pick up your Trump Cuck shirts. Oh, I'm just saying. I'm just letting everyone know because there's some still available and you want to get them for Christmas. Or just get them to wear around for the next 4 years because Trump ain't going anywhere.
There was a bunch of people wearing them last night, which I was annoyed to see.
There's Trump cucks out there, Ron. They're loving it. They're loving the movement. Yeah. And here, I got an update. Mr. Gad Elmaleh is following at Trump Cuck now on Twitter.
Wow.
And
that's a big deal.
At Crimmins.
Look at that ornament. Isn't it pretty?
Oh, wow.
Oh, Barry Crimmins?
Barry Crimmins is following the Trump Cuck.
I wouldn't think of him as a Trump Cuck guy.
He's a Trump Cuck guy. He's loving it. He gets it. You know, he realizes. And we're all Trump cucks.
All right. So where do you go again?
You go to Interrobang.com. And then the link is right there on the front page on the left. You can get yourself a Trump Cuck t-shirt. Double XL sold out.
So here these are. You'll see these ornaments. There's the Thanksgiving thing on one side.
Oh, it's awesome.
And then you, me, and Gail on the other side.
That's the shit.
And then here's another one, which is just Thanksgiving poster. And... There's Vito in his tight pants. So this one was from you, Vito. That's from Party, and you can see that he's got like a golf tee, so I don't know what that does. Party Shots. Bob from there. Par. Okay, if I get it, it's Party Shots Incorporated. PartyShots.com. And that was really nice. So, Vito, you think you want this for your tree, or you want to take it and smash it against the wall?
No, it's 100% going on my tree.
All right.
Why?
Because it's not. I saw all the way from here, I saw my stomach. That's how I knew what it was.
You know, it's... Look at the happiness around him.
Oh, it's me in the background.
Just smiling and laughing. And
with my clipboard.
Yeah. Just enjoying...
Jen, put that on your tree instead.
Still a great surprise for my mom, who I didn't tell that was going to happen.
So they do golf outings. He's a producer and stuff like that. So that was really fun. That was really cool.
If I had a tree, I'd love to have one of those.
You're not even getting a little tree for yourself?
No,
even
no
a little
tree.
Sad tree?
I haven't had a tree in like 6 or 7 years. It's been a long time.
You don't even have parties at your house anymore, huh?
No.
You just party with fucking Zito and those guys?
I'll go out with them, yeah.
That's your crew?
Yeah, it's the crew. There's Mark Zito from Promotions, Ryan from the Morning Mashup, and Jeff the Sax Man, Harry Connick Jr. sax player.
Why don't you go to see Harry's show with him sometime?
They shoot during this time.
Oh, do they really?
Yeah. He's like, come to the show. Just it's every day at noon. I'm like, I can't do that.
I'll give you a day off for a week or two.
What?
And you can go over and just hang out there.
A week? I'd like to be here working. I don't think Harry Connick needs me in the audience every day.
Just once. I tried to hook him up with that comedian yesterday.
I know.
Since they're all into the French stuff. I don't know what it is. I just try to make people friends with each other.
They should be friends, though, Gad and Harry Connick.
Johnny Gogo and his wife had a lovely time last night.
I saw them.
She's really, really hot.
Hell yeah.
I know you shouldn't say that about your friend's wife, but she's really, really cute. Everybody wants to know if Chris ate all the cookies. You ate quite a few.
Oh, well, yeah. I dug in. Maureen did give us a whole boatload of new cookies.
How many cookies you want to eat?
Okay, like a baker's dozen?
That's 13.
Yeah.
Can you eat 13 right now?
Yeah, I'll eat 13 cookies right now.
Grab them, Jen.
Okay.
Grab those cookies. Look at Jen in her funny Christmas sweater.
I've never owned a Christmas sweater. You think this is the year for me?
I did when I was younger. I was a sweater guy when I was a kid, but those are great cookies. Are they all Christmassy?
They're in like a Christmassy like Tupperware, which is actually, I didn't know they sold these.
What, Christmassy Tupperware?
Yeah.
They sell everything. So what is that, like an oatmeal on there?
It's like an oatmeal, yeah.
Okay, good. Enjoy.
Yeah, I didn't eat breakfast today, so this is perfect for me.
You don't ever eat breakfast, right?
Yeah, I don't.
They say breakfast is the least important meal of the day.
Thank God, because I never eat it.
And my buddy Hard Rock Johnny, I want to check in with him. Johnny.
Bennington's.
So great to see your boss, Johnny Gogo, there last night.
Hey, he's not my boss. Let's start with that.
I'll tell you one thing. I feel like we're getting closer with him than you.
Yeah, I can't help it. I have a busy job that I can't just, you know, run around, you know.
Johnny, I've been with you for 8 hours at work. It looks like hanging out at best.
That's when it's a Bennington show. When it's like, when I have a party for 1,000 people, it's a little busy.
Yeah, you're like this. Hey, is everybody doing their job? It's good.
Yes, I can't just leave to go to see. I would, as much as I'd love to.
I think they'd do their job without you, Johnny. I really do. I think you've trained them
that
might, well.
They might, but part of being a boss is you got to be around. That's why Johnny Gogo's not a boss.
I don't know.
And his wife is lovely, by the way. Our lovely Mrs. Gogo is lovely. You are correct in that.
I'm crazy about her.
It's awesome.
I was calling just to congratulate you on an amazing show, from what I heard, on all accounts.
All right, so Johnny gave you a call on the way home?
We texted. Yes, it was an interesting lineup.
Yeah, surprising lineup.
I think I was surprised, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what, Johnny? I should have checked in with you first and, you know, gave you the scoop.
No, you guys don't like me anymore. It's fine.
No. We like you second. That's all. You're the silver.
You're number two.
Look, I don't mind playing number two to Eddie Trunk with you. I don't have to be number one.
I guess.
I've been riding in that silver medal of his friendship for 16 years. Doesn't bother me. Doesn't bother me. I know my place.
It's okay, dude.
It's not. That is not true. Pepper, shut up and eat your cookies.
I am eating my cookies. I'm not going to shut up.
Please, today, dude, take it down just a notch. Let's just have a fucking grown-up day. So, Johnny, what else is up with you? You're all excited about your Giants?
Oh, that was, it was nice. I was at the game that night. Nice. I had a nice little cookout before the game in the snow. Watched them beat the Cowboys. Now I'm going to watch them probably lose the next three games, but, you know,
don't talk that way. Don't talk that way. Off you go.
You know, it's going to be it'll be interesting to see what happens.
I'm starting to think that the Giants and the Redskins could get in.
No, I don't know about both.
Yeah, I think they both could do it.
Cowboys spit the bit and lose them all?
No. Cowboys too. All three teams get in. It's just the East. It's everybody but the Eagles.
I broke a long time standing rule, and I had an Eagle on my fantasy football team. I know you don't talk much about that, but craziness.
I really don't like the fantasy. I'm going to be honest with you, Johnny.
Kinda, you know, I got to tell you.
Broke us up.
It's, to me, I'm not one of those, like, you know, I'm in two fantasy leagues, and I'm not the obsessive, like, I'll check twice a day on a Sunday just to see how it's going. Of course, until next week, when if I were to win this week, I'd be in the championship game for lots of money, then I'll check a little more.
Sure. I understand.
True story.
You know what, Johnny? The show that we did there is the one I had planned to do with you guys on Thanksgiving when you nixed it.
And so I said you can't do that here?
Yeah.
That is not how that happened.
No, you said it's a club show. You go, that's a club show. You go do that in your sleazy clubs. This is, but it all worked out that night too. You know, when that match game was hilarious with you.
Yeah, it worked out well. I had a nice dinner.
All right, Jenny. Need a man.
Bennington's. Yeah. You guys have a good rest of your day.
I'm going to talk to Johnny Gogo about getting you a 3-day weekend for Christmas.
Thanks. Yeah, I'll get his approval.
All right, peace.
Later.
Bye, Johnny.
Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-boom. All right, I'm not going to read some of these Chris things. Hey, Vin. Vin in Jersey. What's up, buddy?
Hey, what's up, Bennington?
Hey.
Just like every bad event in my life, like from 9/11, my old man passing away, and this morning in the hospital with my wife, you guys got me through a tough morning. So I just wanted to thank you. You know, it definitely is payback for getting Fez on that float years ago in the gate parade.
Well, I wish you the best, buddy. I'm sorry that you're having some rough times.
Yeah, no, you guys are the best. So thanks.
All right, take care of yourself, you, my friend. Bye.
You too. Bye.
I hate to hear about that, especially this time of year, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if it's a big Christmas bluff that they run. How many cookies you eat so far, Chris?
I'm going to throw the way through them. Four in.
Well, not quite a third of the way because you added the bakers to the dozen. But you enjoyed them?
Yeah, they're delicious. Yeah. Maureen's a fantastic baker.
You know, if you got yourself a little lady, maybe you'd be having some home-cooked meals.
You think?
Yeah. You could have a life. And someone, Andrea, our friend, writes, I never cringed and laughed so much at the same time. Thanks, I bang. Well, that show, as weird as it was definitely walking that wire of, is this funny or did they go too far? And I don't think we fell off, but we could have very, very easily.
It's still gone bad.
Yeah. So. But I talked to, and people don't know that, every one of those comics who came in and did that loved it. Loved it. That second guy who didn't have any punchlines said he never realized in his career that he did not have punchlines.
This is show is helping him.
But was he a good looking guy, the guy in the little black suit?
He was okay.
Just okay.
Yeah. Right.
See, I might be easier on men than a lot of women are.
I thought he was pretty hot.
He came with a girl, I think, too. So
same time?
Yeah.
Good. That's always the most romantic way.
She looked really good too. So I think,
yeah, but I thought he was a good looking guy. I think he looked like I can't think of this actor's name, but he did Star Wars. He's like the new Star Wars guy.
The dude that was in the Coen Brothers movie too.
Yes. What is his name?
Oscar Isaac.
No, it's Bob Crenshaw. That's his name. Yeah, Oscar Isaac. Son of a bitch. So close. Yeah, Oscar. I thought he had an Oscar Isaac look, but I thought he fucking had an Isaac Newton personality. And I don't even know what that means. But it's another Isaac. He just didn't have a punchline. It was driving me nuts. But Pat Dixon was just chewing that up, though, just enjoying it.
Loving it.
And then Pat was also disappointed because I said, no, none of these. I go, a lot of these kids are doing fucking nothing gigs and bars. And it's just never fucking, you know, and this is a chance for them to get up. And then the first comic come up, Pat works with them. Well, that was a little sad.
I think the good looking guy, what helped him was the 5 o'clock shadow and slick back hair. I feel like that fucking makes it attractive.
So you're like on some kind of like one of those waterhead, but like a waterhead version of a red carpet show. Like you'd say something like that as if you were the fashion police. Fashion police, arrest this man. I got back into a weird fucking Radiohead thing and I can't wait to get out of it.
You don't enjoy it?
Listen to this. Big A writes, Gail, you and Ron are amazing. I was honored being on the same stage with you. Big A, you definitely had the number one reaction to anybody who's done that show ever.
Yeah. Was crazy. People love a Big A.
A Big A.
And just saying a Big A is just fun.
Oh, it's Bob from Party Shots. Bob, how are you, buddy?
Fine.
Yeah.
I'm great. Last night was amazing.
Yeah, it was a crazy night.
I wanted, after the third comic though, I wanted to scream out, will somebody please tell one fucking joke?
Yeah, it's tough.
I couldn't get to a punchline.
Yeah, this is the biggest problem with open mic guys is they do a lot of over-explaining. And somewhere in their head, there's got to be a joke. But I'm always laughing when...
Then it got hot, though.
Yeah. I'm always laughing when they'll do stuff like, all right, any of you guys have a car? And you know how there's a key to start the car in that place? They'll be like, yes, every fucking... Just get beyond all that stuff. Have a little confidence that we all are earthlings.
The heavy guy got it going. He had some good lines in there.
He was a little too good for the show, in my opinion. I thought
probably.
Yeah, but he set up a fun thing of trying to look around him at the judges. That was a lot of fun.
So fucking funny.
Yeah.
Hey, Ron, you made my year talking about this morning.
That's very cool. We're all excited about him.
I take pictures of golf outings, put them on coffee mugs before the golfers get back. So that's what party, it's golf and party.
So as soon as they get back, they get the mug. It happens that fast.
Right. And they're amazed. They're amazed.
I'm amazed just hearing that. And I'm not even saying
it. I actually tried to talk to Chris last Thanksgiving about doing it at Thanksgiving, but he never got back to me, the bastard.
And he never gets back to anyone. That's why I had to go out and get Jen, because I have to say, Jen, just keep an eye on him.
But he did get me tickets for last night and Thanksgiving, so I'm his pal now.
All right, buddy. Great to talk to you.
Bye.
Peace. So when they get back, they're out golfing, they get back, there's a picture in the mug and I'm golfing. I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to take this home. Show it to my chick.
Wait a minute, this just happened. Holy shit.
Bronx owe me. Diane and Nicole were there last night, so you know we were swinging.
Oh, yeah.
We were swinging because they only show up at the best things. And I got to tell you, man, that just the amount of fun that went on with the stand was too much. Too much. Now, by the way, the iBang is... And I've been trying to get names for you so I can get them to the bosses. What a great job that you're doing on this year-end thing.
Yeah.
Here we are. I mean, everybody's going to be gone by tomorrow.
I know.
I mean, you got to get this thing done, I'll say yesterday or the day before to let me know. But we've got just a year in review, which is just really, really great. But the iBang has talked to every major club in the country about what their highlight of the year. I was checking this out yesterday. And the funny thing is, The Stand mentioned us, and so did the Village Underground, as being their favorite on their favorite shows.
That's awesome.
I know, it really is. It's more than you guys get.
It feels really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they said, let me read this. Oh. Even though the producing is shoddy and half-assed.
Oh. You said that, huh? Specifically?
Yeah. It's still the content of the show overruns the bad producing.
Wow.
We also... After Chris left, had some money missing.
That, I'm not stealing from the clubs. I'm not doing that.
The fact that you even yelled that out and you didn't defend fucking shoddy producing is sad. Hey, send Nick in, would you? Because I want to congratulate him.
Young Nick's the best. And he's suggested another intern for next semester.
Get out of here.
Yeah, he's given a qualification.
Qualifications, that's that we say word. In the program. Qualifications when you go in. Something you need to give. Nick, first of all, great producing last night. You heard it from everybody, right?
Yeah, thank you very much. I appreciate that.
You don't know how important it is to just not stand around. You're always moving. You're grabbing stuff. You're figuring out what the next problem is.
Yeah.
Not the problem that you're being asked. We're losing you to goddamn Seth Meyers.
Yeah, I want to just thank you guys for the semester. Seriously, I had a great time. I learned so much from everybody here, and it was just a blast, and I'm gonna miss you guys a lot, seriously.
What I would wish is that these guys would learn from you with the hustle. I looked over at Vito last night, and he had grown roots. Ugh. Trying to do a tree joke, standing around like a tree, and I said roots, trying to think that even funny word would work. But who's coming in today. We got some guests.
Jesse David Fox from Vulture.com.
All right, this is a really good point. Go to that Vulture page. Jesse David Fox wrote an amazing article about Seth Meyers finding himself. You already read it?
Yeah, I saw it.
Well, the writer of that is coming in a little bit.
That's awesome.
And you and him can, you could go to him and say, I'm going to be your inside man. I'm going to sell you information. It's important
to keep my job there. I got to make sure.
Sell information. Did you see in a college rank somebody from a radio station that was covering when somebody like Wake Forest and went and sold a game plan to anybody that they were playing? And I was amazed to see the people in the news going, well, that's football. You can, because they do an honor code to the fucking players all the time.
Yeah.
A player can fucking lose a scholarship for having a gal in his room, but these guys can say, oh, we steal plays from the other place. This is supposed to be college, guys. It literally is supposed to be college where we teach people to become young adults and good citizens. Instead, loving, touching, stealing, squeezing. That's what they're up to. When do you start for Seth?
I have my orientation this past Monday. I pick it up again on this upcoming Monday, and I'm working 3 days, and then we have off until after Christmas.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Sweet. By the way, you did also do a great job last night, Vito. I understood that you held the curtain closed.
There was like a champagne toast going on upstairs, so I had to like stand there and like make sure the noise wasn't coming through.
So you're using your body to block noise. That's your...
It's wall sound.
I was really trying to because they were being
the wall
really
is soundless. You're already done eating cookies, aren't you? You can't finish.
I'm at 7. I'm moving on 8.
All right. I want to do a diabetes test in just a couple of minutes.
It's a test positive.
Boom. Sit. What are you doing? See who's at the stand tonight. I don't know what the story is with you, Chris, anymore. I get tired of the same shirt every day. I am excited that the Trump cuck shirts are selling out. And then next week, we start the year in review, and you're going to get a complete year in review show. It's pretty goddamn great.
Of everything in comedy over the year of 2016.
Oh, my God. That was your clarification. Everything in comedy ever in 2016. Do me a favor. Try to take him to Seth Meyers. And if the Fallon show is too noisy, I got a guy who can block sound with his body. That's his X-Men thing.
Tonight to stand at the 8 p.m. show, it's Christian Finnegan, Mike Lawrence, Sean Patton, Ari Shaffir, Tim Dillon, and more. And then on the 10 p.m. show, it's Ari Shaffir, Joe List, Sean
Patton. I thought Mike Lawrence left and they had the big going away party for him.
I think the party happened, but he hasn't left just yet.
That's odd. I just feel like when your party happens, you should get in a truck and be waving at the end of it.
Never to be seen again.
Yeah, that to me is leaving.
You're going away.
Yes, Chris.
Maybe on social media. Sorry,
well, you gotta be on. You can't stop people from social media.
Start a new social media account.
Well, I'm only on Pinterest.
You pin stuff lately?
Yeah.
We'll have a good pin.
Look who it is. It's Mrs. Gogo. We were just giving you big compliments today.
No way.
Yeah. If we were all saying, if anything happens to your husband, we want you. Each of us was saying that.
Yes.
I told him my career goal is to be a Bennington intern when my kids go to school.
You are more than welcome. matter of fact, I'm losing neck now to Seth Meyers.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
I'll be there.
Just like I lost Seth Meyers on SNL. To the Seth Meyers show, which I guess is a move up. I don't know. To me, it's all confusing. What can we do for you, darling?
I had to tell you, I felt terrible when you started the show. You said Gail went to a funeral, and last night I told her to have fun in Philly.
I heard you say that.
Awful.
Yeah, I heard you say that. And then she said to me, how am I supposed to have fun at a funeral?
Yeah.
How can I have fun when my heart is breaking? Mrs. Gogo is such an asshole.
She, probably where we are now, she's reading something in the church. They wanted her to do a reading.
Oh, really?
And I'm like, do it Maniscalco voice. I mean, that thing killed for you last night. Chipotle. You know what really makes me uncomfortable is how she gets her little body going for the chopper in the kitchen. Very, very, very odd. But, yeah, why would you say somebody to have fun when they're going to a funeral?
I had no idea. I thought maybe she was taking a day off. Yeah. Going to do a little.
Yeah, everybody likes to take a day off and go to Philly, dig a hole, and put a loved one there.
I thought she was just going to have a chicken hoagie.
You know what? The thing about, I mean, they will be having hoagies, of course. There's no doubt about it. Because it is Philly. And I think she's reading some Walt Whitman, which, you know, because they have the bridge there, they're like, oh,
of course,
you know, let's keep everything Philly. She's going to read something from the first Rocky script. I believe it was Paulie's scene. You bust it. Get out of here. You bust it.
Interesting choice.
You wear her Betsy Ross dress.
All right, sweetie. It was so good to see you last time. I'm so glad you came.
You too. I loved being there. It was amazing.
All right. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye.
I'm telling you, you better go out of your way to just say, anytime these guys are doing a show, it's going to be great. Who would have thought? Ant stopping by, Eastside stopping by, Pat Dixon, who, quite frankly, I think Big A just really planned it last night.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he tore him a new one.
He found a little wordplay with the name Dixon. That shocked us all.
It got ugly, to be totally honest.
I don't think it was ugly. I saw people clapping and jumping up and down. Kenneth, Denver.
Hey, how's it going, Bennington?
Hey.
So I called back in February, and I wanted to let you know that I have been doing stand-up comedy since April, and it's been going well.
Where are you working out of, Kenneth?
Denver.
What are the big clubs there that you're working?
Oh, okay, yeah. I hit a mics. I still can't seem to get booked on a show in Denver, but I went out to Wichita, Kansas, and did some shows there, and then I also went up to Omaha, Nebraska, and I performed there as well.
Wichita and Omaha.
Yes, sir.
Sounds good, buddy. How much time can you do now?
15 to 20.
Sweet.
I've been working on a new 15, and it hasn't been going too well. I made a transgender joke that actually really pissed someone off.
All right, let me hear the joke. We'll see if we can help you punch it a little bit.
Oh, yeah. I was changing the tranny in the car recently, and she said I can dress myself, thank you.
And I just say, what's not to love? You know what I mean?
Right.
You know why?
That's
it's
what
edgy.
I've been hearing.
It's edgy. All right, my friend, congratulations to you. Have a great 2017.
I wanted to add that I'm coming out to New York for my 30th birthday in April.
In April. Get a hold of us. Maybe we'll put you on Comedy 101.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
All right. Peace.
All right. Bye.
Could you get him on Seth Meyers? And I'm not even talking about a long set. I'm saying 5-6 minutes.
I'll see what I can do.
That would be great.
What kind of juice you have over there?
Seems like he's running things. If he's anything like here. How many cookies you done?
I'm at 9 right now.
You better slow it down and just admit that you're a loser.
I'm not a loser. I'm going to finish this baker's dozen of cookies. You know how much oatmeal's in my fucking stomach right now?
Well, you know what? Oatmeal is a breakfast food, buddy. You don't have him breakfast.
There's a raisin in here.
Jim, what's the most amount of cookies you ever eat? Let me guess. I'm going to say at one time in your life, you ate one sleeve of Oreos.
Yeah.
You have.
For sure, yeah.
I don't think anyone has not eaten a sleeve of Oreos.
It's impossible not to.
Okay. Thanks for the backup.
I can't, like, if I'm in a store, I can't buy them because I'll fucking wreck the whole thing in the night.
Yeah, no shit. We've been around you. You've eaten all of our food when we went out for a second.
I'm not drinking, I'm not smoking. I got to do something with my mouth and hands.
I understand.
Chewing bar straws like a fucking psychopath.
I know, Chris. Psychopath is the right word to use. You're a psychopathic loser. Now, I'm going to give you an exit interview. Who was more helpful to you when you were here, Vito or Chris?
Oh, man. I worked with Vito a lot.
Okay, so
I learned a lot from Vito, but I also learned a lot from Chris. He taught me the board, and then Vito also taught me a lot about research and taught me a lot about the programs we use here. So I honestly can't say, I'm not just saying this because I don't want to pick one. I'm just saying this because I honestly learned about as equal or enough from both of them.
All right, that's fair enough. So you don't have to decide on it now. And just gut reaction. I'm telling you, you have to take one of these guys home for dinner, meet your mom, have dinner. Who do you take home? Just gut, Joe.
Choose wisely.
I'm going to say Vito, but that's only because he's an Italian.
Only because he's Italian. We all know the reason. Shit, I would never introduce you to my parents. Don't take that as a fucking insult.
I'm going to take it as an insult.
Chris, I would bring both of you guys home, seriously. No, if I brought him, I'd bring you too. Don't worry.
Just me. That's the rules.
It happened. Off. You know what? Look, hey, when I brought up that Johnny picked Daddy Trunk over me, I'm not angry about it. I want him to have freedom. You know, when the thing that you're doing right now is showing a lack of belief in yourself, Chris. You know, maybe it's the 10 cookies that you just finished. But sometimes I think you just don't believe in yourself.
Any more Tums? I'm getting a lot of heartburn.
I think that Frenchman stole it from
me. God damn it, Dad.
I'm even trying to read what he was reading. So he's deciding what this product is called. And I think he called it calcium carbonate instead of Tums. And I looked at it, it's so tiny above it. There was a word last night. He was going to do Gotham Comedy Club, which was right up the road, and that Jerry was stopping in.
Wow.
No, I wasn't supposed to say it. When I say Jerry, Seinfeld. Yes.
Yes.
He's as you described him to me, Jen, a white comedian. She puts white before everything. She goes, "Are you guys having some white food?" And I'm like, "No, it's not white food. It's just food."
Why you do that?
Now we're going to have a little food in here. Yes, tomorrow, and we did not know.
Oh,
I mean the amount of places that we were going to order from, and then the fact that you don't eat the thing from there.
It was, what was it, like a chicken wing place or
close? Had to do. Burger. I mean, it was meats of several kinds, but you don't like meat. You have to go out. Now, is that you don't like it, or is it for health reasons?
Health.
Yeah.
I feel like it's just better to not eat meat. But better for my system.
But look at Vito. He eats meat. He's doing great. Chris has meat with his cookies.
I'm a meat cookie guy. You know that.
For examples of great health.
He's being sarcastic. I'm being serious.
He's a. If I actually had a nickname for Chris, it would probably be Meaty Meats. Meaty Meats. When there's not enough meat in regular meat, you get Meaty Meats.
Love Meaty Meats. The perfect amount of meats.
One time, I'm with him, and he had a rare steak, right? We're out in a nice place. And he's just taking he's just jabbing these big pieces of steaks and rolling them in the juice, right, of the rare steak. And he goes like this, "I loves the blood." He says, "I loves the blood" to me. And I'm like, dude, just fucking relax for 5 minutes.
I loves it, Ron.
I called it blood once when I was a kid. My whole family fucking attacked me when I was sitting at the table.
Really?
And I said, yeah. He goes, "There's a lot of blood in the steak." And they did not want to bring up the fact, but I was being honest. That's blood when you stab into a steak. Why are we acting like we're not carnivores? We are. But you will eat fish.
Yeah. Love fish. Couldn't let that one go.
Of course you love fish because you have no meat to eat. I'd love fish too if there was no meat. Tom Hanks. She eats the Tom Hanks diet when he was stuck on that island. By the way, guess they what? Found out what that island was.
What was it?
Staten. That what? Fucker was on Staten Island for 4 years.
What a shithead for being lost in Staten Island.
Oh, I thought you meant for just being in Staten Island. my favorite part of Staten Island is the something kills. I don't know which one.
Fresh Kills.
Kidding, dude. You don't have to jump into that. It's because everything's called the Kills. You fucking lit.
My neighborhood's Dutch Kills.
Is it?
Yeah. Because apparently the Dutch settled Astoria and they fucking call everything Kills. I guess Kills means neighborhood.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
It's weird. Well, we pushed the fucking Dutch out of here pretty quick. And by we, I mean the English. Had nothing to do with me. I don't know why it takes some pride to what another country did years ago. But, you know, it's Christmas in New York City now. You've been over 30 Rock and enjoying it?
Yeah, I have.
You've been going looking at the windows and everything?
Yeah, I'm obsessed with the lights. Like, once I go outside, I'm, like, Snapchatting around here all the lights and the decorations. Love it.
I want you to Snapchat for Bennington in the coming year. Vito just completely dropped the ball by doing just huge close-ups of his face and talking about things that weren't true.
We were doing Sister Act 2 last week. It's my favorite sequel.
Oh, God.
Have you no shame, Fido? There's no shame on you whatsoever.
It's a great movie.
You went to film school, and then you're going to turn around and tell us that Sister Act 2 is a great movie.
Well, like, I think as far as sequels go, better, like, I think as far as how much better it was than the original, really takes the cake.
Do you know who hates Sister Act 2? Whoopi Goldberg and the cast of Sister Act 2. You actually see her counting money in one scene. She's just going, this stinks, but look at all this money.
But they saved St. Francis Prep High School.
God.
Why do you know all these fucking plot details?
Well, he watched it, Chris. Unlike you, he's not fucking thrown off watching a comedy, going, I don't understand what's happening right now. He can follow plot. When is your big show? When are you doing it?
Which one?
You only do one fucking show with your buddies.
I decided, Ray, that's tonight at 7 p.m. on Dash, 8 p.m. on Dash Digital Network.
I'm going to come and be your guest tonight.
Want to hang out? Hell yeah.
No, I don't want to hang out. I want to do a fucking show. That's the problem with you, is that you consider it hanging out. I would much rather just consider it an actual show. Vito, you had an idea for a show, and I'm nixing it right now.
Okay. The Black and White Cookie Podcast is no more.
First of all, you're not calling something the Black and White Cookie Podcast. That's stupid. It sounds like a child's doing it. What's your favorite movie you've seen so far this year?
I haven't seen any of the warm-up season movies yet. I'm going next week.
The warm-up season movies. Do you mean the Oscar movies?
Yes.
Okay.
On a La La Land.
Saw Deadpool and you saw Star Wars. Pick one. Which do you like better?
I liked Star Wars. Disappointed me because it was like way too much. Like it was like a little kid comedy made by Disney for the most part. And I like Deadpool. I like the satire of this superhero genre that like I'm pretty sick of at this point.
And yet you go to every single one of them.
No, I really slowed down with the superhero movies as like they've like kept going and going and going. Because you have to see every single one to know what's happening in the others, and I can't keep up with like six of these a year.
You can't keep up with anything. This is one of the many things you can't keep up with. You should just came in and said, I can't keep up. That's my review. I should have you do movie reviews for the show.
I would love to do movie reviews.
You don't see enough movies to do them.
If I was doing movie reviews, I'd go to every movie opening weekend.
But you don't even have to go opening weekend. You work here. You can go to screening rooms.
Favorite movie of the year was probably the one we both liked.
Oh, sure. Well, the one we both liked. This is a way to try to curry favor from me. Oh. That's not going to work in this goddamn town.
He just wants curry.
No, the link. The
Tim Curry.
The Linklater movie. Everybody wants some.
I want some, too. That's based on a Van Halen song.
Yeah, no.
Who's your favorite member of Van Halen?
Oh, well... Van Halen was the first band.
There's only one answer to this. Who's your favorite member?
Edward.
The answer is Michael Anthony, who shocked the world with his bass playing.
Fucked up, Vito. You're not even a real fan.
I saw that, and I think this is a really fucking funny bit, and I wish we would have thought of it first, but Jimmy Kimmel did a thing of who knows more about Metallica, and they had a super fan, and then the band Metallica. And I'm like, that's a funny fucking bit. We should have did that with Marcus Hook. Had him and Seinfeld together.
They did it with Ozzy a while back, and Ozzy lost badly. But last night, yeah, like Metallica just crushed this dude, and he didn't win his guitar.
They should have just gave it to him.
Instead, they're bringing him to a concert, which
not the same.
Who hasn't gone to a concert?
He's a super fan. He's gone to dozens of fucking Metallica concerts. They fucked him, is what they're doing.
How are you fucked if you get to do anything for free? How's that getting fucked?
Because he wanted the guitar. That's what he was playing
for. You
can
purchase them. You're not fucked by losing a... This is you. You lose and expect to be given something. How many cookies have you had?
I'm up to 11. I'm almost up to a straight dozen.
Yeah.
Breaking into a fucking baker's.
Did you say thank you for the cookies?
Maureen, thank you so much for these cookies.
Do you tell people how to get a big Trump cuck shirt?
You go to interrobang.com to get a Trump cuck t-shirt.
Well, you do a bad job selling stuff.
It's a perfect gift for the holiday season. It looks great. It's a fantastic picture of me on the shirt. And it's a beautiful red color. It pops really well.
Sal from Imaging says, hashtag Trump cuck. We still don't know what it means, but okay, I'll go with it. That's embarrassing.
Sal from Imaging should be going to the interrobang.com and picking
up
a shirt.
He's already got it. All right, he's posed with a picture of his shirt.
Okay, I didn't see that.
He's wearing it right now. And now you're still telling him, of all people, to go to pick some up.
You beautiful bastard.
All right, we got a break here. Boy, it's really thrown off without Gail here and Chris fucking eating cookies. Nick, you're the best, buddy.
Thank
Seriously.
You very much.
Really, really proud of you and your internship this year. Very excited for you. I expect to see you sitting next to Seth Meyers by the end of this next semester.
You're going
to
do it.
So. Thank you.
And who's this kid that you recommended?
My friend Greg. He's actually, I was like, they will love your accent. It's the first thing I said. I was like, first of all, they're going to love your accent. He's from Australia.
Oh.
Yeah. He's been all over the country. He'll tell you when... when he gets you, I'll tell you where he's been. He's been all over the country. He's been all over the world.
No one travels like Australians. It's true. You go anywhere in the world, and you run into Australians.
Yeah.
Because they, it's a part of their culture just to see everything. And it's also a part of their culture is they don't care where they sleep. You know what I mean? If they're in a bed, fine. You want them under the bed. You want them in the backyard. They're just happy travelers, and it's true. You don't go anywhere in the planet without running into a backpacking Australian. I think it's because their own country is so massive. Like, when you get there, the whole center is just gutted out like a donut. You know what I mean? Like, you just drive and there's nothing there. And they're close to Asia, so they're used to hop jump. And then once they get on the road, they just stay out there. Wow. But Australians all the time are like, you're 18, take a year, 2 years, and travel. That's what they say to their children. Sleep outside for the next couple of years. All right, we break. We're back. Bennington.
Welcome back to Bennington. Jesse David Fox is here. He's the senior comedy editor at Vulture.com. You can read his recent articles, The 20 Best Sketches of 2016 and The 10 Best Comedy Specials of 2016 at Vulture.com. On Twitter, it's at Jesse David Fox, and he has a podcast premiering in February.
Well, I'm glad to see you finally got into this podcast yes. game, because I got big ideas for it. It's all happening.
Yeah, I think it's going to be pretty big.
Yeah.
people seem like they're going to download some of them.
Well, you know, the thing is, just because they download them doesn't mean they listen. Because I've downloaded a lot, oh, really? And I'm like, oh, God, don't really have time for that.
Yeah, I think that's not even my first concern is just getting them to download it. Listen to it.
Listen, that's on your own.
Yeah.
You know what you're going to be doing it on yet? Or
yeah, so the idea it's going to be, at least at first, it'll be 10 episodes where each episode will be an interview with a comedian or a comedy writer, and we're going to talk about one joke of theirs and just kind of use that to kind of break down their process and the kind of their point of view, but use it just kind of from the perspective of one joke.
One joke and one joke only.
One joke and one joke.
I always like to say that there are certain people that are defined for jokes no matter how long. Of course, the Hot Pockets with Mr. Jim Gaffigan. Yes. And, you know, you do stuff with Jim and somebody will show up with Hot Pockets as if this hasn't happened every day of his life.
He's probably signed more Hot Pockets than Kiss has signed breasts.
And in the meantime, he's like, yeah, I wrote that joke a long time ago. I get it.
Yeah, Paul Tompkins has a thing about, he used to have a bit about why cake's better than pie. And it's been like maybe 20 years ago and people still bring it up. And he goes, I don't like either.
Yeah,
I just like wrote a joke like 20 years ago.
But I do agree with him, cake is better than pie.
I like pie much better.
It's a cooked fruit. And I'm willing to say this. A fruit is better just left to nature.
Oh, that's very nice.
Just left in. You can't tell me that grapes aren't better than whatever that gooey stuff that they put inside a donut. They'd be better off just putting grapes in there.
I think you've come up with a new idea.
The next Bring me podcast, grapes, everybody. Yeah.
You're going to sign a bunch of grapes.
Yeah. But, you know, this is year-end time, so you're doing a lot of your stuff. But before we get into that... The Seth Meyers piece that you did was amazing.
Oh, thank you so much. I've never been more proud of anything I've
written. Is that right?
Yeah, it was hard to do, so I was happy that it was something I was proud of.
It was one of those things where while I'm reading about halfway through, I'm like, this could be a book. You know what I mean? Because I'm always interested in what goes on in that building across the street because it's so historical. You know?
And it's something that, you know... Why, like, Seth, he's like, he also kind of likes that he's a process-y guy. Mm-hmm. You know, he's a process guy, so I wanted to write a process piece. So, but also to kind of think about what he's doing. But, he has that kind of SNL mentality of like, the show goes on because this is when we taped the show, so we're going to figure that out. But yeah, I was fascinated by it. I mean, I had a lot more stuff about like, the jokes they change and how they changed it.
Right.
But, you know, it, you know, had a, only a little bit of the taste of that stuff, and then I could save it for the book.
Yeah, like I said, I would totally, you know, have kept on going chapter by chapter with that. And by the way, I still think Seth's entire personality is still all over SNL. I mean, in terms of SNL, very few people have put their fingerprint on it as much as he has. And in some ways, I think it hurts. I think it hurts Michael Che, who I believe is much funnier.
Yeah, that's interesting, because I think, you know, there's his tone was definitely there in terms of like how it's run now. Like the tone of that office is much nicer, and I think that's a Seth thing. But yeah, I think it takes a while for them to figure out what sort of weekend update type of joke they want to do. And like the first, usually like the first minute seems like those guys where it's like they're riffing against each other and they kind of pile on jokes. It's not just like, but the back half, which is kind of the weirder stuff, you know, it's just like an alligator was found in a blah, blah, blah. Those type of jokes. Those are just like Seth type jokes.
Yeah.
That feels unnatural to Che. Like it feels like so weird to see those jokes coming out of his mouth.
And then, you know, he just did that special and the special was great. And it was very much Che.
Yeah.
And you, when you see him around town, he's just totally different.
Yes.
Than the guy on TV.
I think, you know, I think it's going to, you know, it took Seth a couple of years. It takes all these, it's for whatever reason, very few people come out of the gate and they're like, yes, this is exactly different and what we wanted, especially at this point where SNL is such a, it's like such on a conveyor belt. It's harder for it to switch.
Yeah, well, the show now, it seems like it is about the show more than any player, maybe at any other time in history. Sometimes that's to, you know, a huge problem for the show.
Yeah.
But right now, it just feels like the New England Patriots, where if one person comes down, we got another one, and you're like, oh, it's just as good.
I was talking to a former cast member. I was about to say who, then I remember the conversation was off the record. But he was saying this is this last episode, the last few episodes he watched. And he's like, this is the first time I realized, oh, someone's going to say this is their favorite cast. Like that it's gelled and they're a specific group of people that started around the same time. And Chris Kelly and Sarah Schneider, as co-head writers with Brian Tucker, have done a really good job of like tightening it up so there's different types of things, but they all feel like they're operating at the same level. And again, it's like Kay McKinnon's really great, but she's still not she's not like what Kristen Wiig used to do, where she's in like everything. She's in a lot, but it's still, it really is an ensemble in an interesting way.
Yeah, and in some ways, when you don't have a star, it's kind of hurtful for the era. You know what I mean? Like, when you look back and people think, oh, Bill Murray or Belushi, they were at some points bigger than the whole show. But now it just feels like that show and maybe, you know, maybe they need some more drugs. Maybe they need, you know what I mean? Like, there needs to be a scandal or two. Because they've just got, you know, Bobby Moynihan is a professional. He's just a professional guy. He's ready to go. You want me to carry this sketch or be the fourth lead? I don't care. You know, I'm here.
Yeah, I can't speak to how many drugs they should or should not do, but it was something that, I remember Jenny Slate was talking about when she was only there for a year, but she thought there was going to be a lot more drugs.
Right.
She's like, you know, like, not that she needed to be up at all hours of the night, but for the most part, I think, and that's a Seth thing of being like, we can just do a good job at this show, and we can still be up really late for no reason, but like, we'll just be working. We're not going to be
partying and screaming and fucking up Lauren's office. They would just go in there, just spray painting. You know, read about those early years and they were nuts, you know, and now it's professional, but you do kind of miss the nut. Well, here's how different the show is. Taryn is now going to Hamilton.
Yeah.
And this is...
And you're like, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. Because he's a professional doing professional work.
Yeah. Well, and he was hired. He was one of the more professional people almost ever hired. Because he was like, he had like a decent amount of like LA acting E work. Mm-hmm. And then he came on the show. You're like, yeah, you should be on television. Like Mikey Day is another one. Mikey Day has been on doing comedy television for now like 10 years. He had a lead on an NBC sitcom. And then he was a very good writer for the show, so they promoted him. And it already feels like he's been a cast member for like three years. And that's because he's ready to be on television, and he knows how to write for that show. So all the sketches that he used to give Taryn or Bobby now keeps for himself. And you're like, he's like he's a lead, and he's been in the show for like five episodes.
That's so funny. It's bad news for Bobby.
I know, right?
Like that would have been mine last season. but this is the year-end wrap-up time, and you get to the specials, and there's... an amazing amount of specials out there. And really, really good specials. I'm looking at your top 10 list. You probably could have added easily another 10.
Yeah, easily.
And
I had another, and like I wanted to do 10, but I had another 5 that I had like kind of already in my head. I mean, that I was like, oh yeah, those would be the other 5. And then these.
Yeah.
And it didn't, you know, in years past, they used to include albums. They used to include half hour specials.
Right.
But there were, I actually literally lost count at 80 when the amount of stand up specials there were this year.
It's insane.
But I've heard it was maybe even 100. What was it, like 10 years ago? 8?
Yes. If you're lucky, you know, like it used to be, you know, like even go back like 20, 25 years, it would be like Dennis Miller would do one.
Yeah.
And then, you know, people would come over to your house and stuff to watch it, you know, like it was a prize fight. And then Carlin would do one. And now it's like every week there's a special. No one, yeah. There's a special. There's a special.
Yeah. I mean, Netflix did 22, 24 of them.
Yeah.
Netflix, I like that, and then, you know, and Comedy Central still trying to keep up, so they did their, like, 10, and then CISO did 10.
Yeah.
Like, HBO was still doing them, Showtime still did a ton, I learned Vimeo,
Epics.
I learned Vimeo did 5.
Yeah.
I remember when I heard the Vimeo, I was like, you had to be CISO or above is now how I think.
Yeah, where you gotta be with it, but.
Yeah.
How are the CISO numbers? Are there a lot of people saying if you do a CISO special?
I don't know. I don't know. The CISO spin is that they got their subscriber rate is doing well, but it's hard to say. I mean, I think what CISO, I mean, probably you're hoping for is they're going to give specials to like a little bit more fringe opportunities. People might be on like, you know, Netflix also is like a queue of people now waiting to have their specials from.
Yeah.
People are shooting their specials in like, you know, like this. And actually heard a lot of the Netflix special where you saw a lot of people doing like Trump jokes of like a year ago, like right before or after the election, like Che's was the hardest. Che was like, well, he's definitely going to lose.
And yeah, right.
Comes out like 3 days afterwards. But Netflix literally has like you're like in a line of people to do it. So I think for some people, CISO was just like an opportunity to kind of get it out there already. And also they gave specials to, you know, I think people that don't get as many opportunities. Like Doug Stanhope got one. I think it takes longer for him to kind of get one than normal. I love Janine Garofalo got one. They had a few that I really liked. What was the other one? Laura Kilmartin, who I think this is her first special, and it was a very specific, weird one in that it was only jokes about her dad dying.
Yeah.
And it was fantastic and very specific, and you're like, CISO is going for that. They don't need, because the Netflix specials look so fancy.
Yeah.
And the CISO specials aren't trying to, they're more like, let's capture an event than like,
well,
let's try to create.
Yeah. I mean, I prefer to see a special in a club to a big theater. I don't need the shot from the back. Yeah, yeah. I don't need the flying fox going over top, you know, in a big set. It doesn't exactly work. I like, you know, that thing that looks like somebody just walked up in Philly or Cleveland and they're battling out. But Ali Wong's special that she did, I think, is a special people are going to be talking about 20 years from now.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely stuck. It was interesting, you know, I write about stand-up specials and comedy, and you know, people in comedy know about them, but specials usually aren't things people talk about.
They're not that special.
They're not. I mean, there's so many of them, and also you just don't know what's going to cross over. And I think Ali had a few things that really just immediately shot. I think her WTF interview was very good. Mm-hmm. I remember that was part of it. And then also, like, the image of it was like, well, at least some curiosity factor, and then she has good heart jokes.
The physicality of what she did was unbelievable.
Yeah.
And also, unbelievable.
Yeah. And it was, I mean, like, you know, she's a very good stand-up that could have been on the list anyway, but like the contrast of the type of jokes she does and then seeing a person who's 8 months pregnant was like an undeniably interesting thing to watch. And people love it. And it's really cool when people like any stand-up, because it's like not many specials cross over. Like, you know, they cross over when they get this or that, but usually the special itself is not the thing that crosses over.
Yeah, it's not the thing that normally works to make somebody a household name. And you saw that. And Segura had this, I think, the year before, where it was a game changer for him and made people suddenly want to go to Netflix.
First Netflix ones, especially. Yeah. Like John Mulaney became a theater act just from his special moving from Comedy Central to Netflix.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think if you really, and but it's hard to know because not Netflix doesn't share their numbers.
No, they don't share their numbers, but I see what happens with people's draws after doing it. I see, you know, that Ali is doing theaters now. And, you know, before that, and the interesting thing is I saw her right after, and I'm like, oh, what kind of feedback? She's like, well, I've been with the baby. This is, now I'm just going out, but I sold out Washington, so it looks good, I guess. You know, and then since then, and Segura is like saying to her, no, you got to start spending money because you're going to keep making money. Stop hoarding it and feeling like you don't have money. You do now.
Yeah, you're going to get like a good 5 years of like your minimum of like you can play like theaters and beyond. The ability to people to jump to theaters now is of like regardless of the ability to play to jump to basketball arenas. But like theaters are now a thing that again, I think like 10 years ago, it was like a handful of people were playing theaters. And now, you know, Ali Wong with one special can jump to. Which is great.
It's like, unbelievable.
Yeah, it's great.
But to bring up the arenas like Louis C.K. did Madison Square Garden, doesn't even make the news anymore.
Yeah.
You know? It doesn't make the news. That would have been, you know, when, let's say Dice sold out Madison Square Garden.
Yeah.
Time Magazine was writing, like, this is unbelievable. Why? Who's going to see this? And now these guys are playing Madison Square Garden and it's not on TV. No one's talking about it. It's just, I tried to get tickets. I couldn't. You know,
it's weird, dates, but whatever.
Yeah, I mean, Kevin Hart played a professional football stadium.
Yeah.
I was embarrassed to learn that Larry the Cable Guy had already played a football stadium.
Yeah, in Nebraska.
Yeah, I just didn't even.
Yeah. But both of those guys were hometown guys.
Yeah, but still, a football stadium's a really big place.
Yeah, it's 80,000 people.
Really? And though people knew about it, but it wasn't like. Cover of everything being like this, that's an extraordinary thing to happen. One little guy on stage.
I know. And that ended a, you know, 50 city arena tour that he's playing 20,000 seats. And then he goes into Philly and he's doing 75,000-80,000. And then it's made into a movie. Yeah. And you
the
just
movie seat, like the funny thing is like, who hasn't seen Kevin? Like, who are those other fans who want to see the, I think the special was good. I thought it was shot really interesting. Like, you know, I think because he had the money to, instead of just doing like those really cheesy shots to the crowd.
Yeah.
It seemed like they had a lot of people with like handheld cameras in the crowd. So it like felt like you're actually a little bit more immersed. But I was just like, he's in a football stadium.
Yeah. Attell was doing that with that late night show that he had from the underground where he was having GoPros and it felt like somebody was sitting in front of you. And I talked to people from like TV production, like, oh, I hate that. And I go, I can't tell you how much more I like it.
Yeah.
I don't want these things to be overly professional.
Yeah.
You know?
It was something of when I was at Montreal Just for Laughs at the Roast Battle tournament.
Yeah.
I sat next to Louis C.K. for one of them. And he was like, why is it shot so formalized?
Yeah.
I just overheard him. Like, he was just like, why would it not be shot like the show in LA is, where it's like very intimate? It felt like such a production. And I feel like there is something loss of like, why aren't specials shot intimately, like what it's like to consume it, is something that, you know, Mike Birbiglia, when I did a profile of him for the New York Magazine a few months ago, and he talked a long time about how he shot his special. Like, he cares about that. And he's like, we realized, just put it really close. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't need mid shots. Just like, basically, they did a test run at UCB. So they had all the cameras close up, basically. And they're like, let's just do that. We'll have all the cameras really close up. Because, like, when you watch a special, your eyes don't zoom out.
Right. Exactly.
You have eyeballs. They look directly at the thing.
But, you know, Scorsese did that 40 years ago with The Last Waltz. Yeah. He says, I'm not showing the audience because who cares to show that some lady is happy? You know what I mean? Like, you yourself are experiencing it. But I don't know whether it was caught up with HBO and Showtime for years that they just got into, here's how we do a special. This is what a special looks like.
I do wonder also if it was just an editing trick. Now, I never even thought about that. I wonder if it was like, because they, you know, usually most specials are shot where they do two back to back and they have to cut them together. I wonder if it's just like, oh, that's an edit point. Maybe it's not, but now that seems like maybe that was like to two birds with one stone. But also like those old comedy shows were like set in venues where like the venues were the star attraction.
Yes.
So I think that's probably also where it's like, oh, we need to show people drinking.
Right. Yeah.
I was talking to a comedian yesterday that said, at the Gotham television show, they still showed people dropping checks. And I was like, like, this is, that is beyond, who wants that?
Well, you know, nothing has changed. I mean, for having like 35 years of this is what a comedy show looks like when you go out, opener, middle, you know, now, anytime you go out to a comedy show, you expect something completely different than you've ever seen before.
Yeah, I mean that. I think that's nice with, you know, one alternative comedy happening, and then also everyone just kind of intermixing. Mm-hmm. Is you'll just have people that you know at this point almost anything could be at a comedy show.
Right.
I know the one time I ever did stand up, it was at a show, and then the last act, it was very dark, wanted to be cut. She brought someone on stage, and she was like, "Whip me!" And like people were like, "Is this funny?" And then she was like, "Cut me." And then they're like, okay, that's the end of the show. But it was like, was she trying to do comedy, or is this now like we're post-comedy?
Yeah, we are.
And just weirdos are like, oh, I can go on stage and be a weirdo.
Yes, it's the Middle Ages, as you know, and let's just bring up the freaks one after another. Yeah.
Jesse David Fox in the studio. Jesse's the senior comedy editor at Vulture.com. You can read his recent articles, the 20 best sketches of 2016, and the 10 best comedy specials of 2016 at Vulture.com. And on Twitter, it's at Jesse David Fox. And he has a podcast premiering in February.
And no name for it yet.
I think it's going to be called Good One.
Good One.
Good One, a podcast about jokes.
About jokes. You have any guests lined up yet?
I do not.
Yeah, smart. That's good. Keep it open.
But, you know, so if you hear now, you can email me and we can, you know, set something up. But, yeah, mid-February, and then it'll be 10 weeks, and then we'll see you from there.
It's all, you know, it's also a time where, and I was looking at year-end stuff, that the TV shows are so much better than the movies.
Yeah.
That if you had the offer to do a TV show or a movie, you might lean towards TV show now.
Yeah. I mean, in terms of creative freedom, yeah, I feel like you have to. Like, you can really, you like Baskets can get on the air, and it's a specific singular thing where the two movies Zach Galifianakis put out this year were not interesting things. No one saw them. You know, the good things, I guess, about movies is they don't take that much time to shoot. So, and you get paid a lot of money. But I think otherwise, in terms of like creative expression, I feel like almost any comedian prefers having a TV show where you can really, these networks, you know, FXX and CISO or Netflix, they really are like, yeah, it's your show.
Your show. Run with it. Don't go over budget.
It's a lot of good notes. It's like when I talk to comedians, it's like they still get notes, but the notes are you like, take this if you want, but most of them are like pretty good. And it's like, oh, we just watched it. And these are things we may be confused by. But I think, and that's the thing that Louis just changed by showing that it was a viable option.
What's he got? Four shows that he was producing this year.
Was this
Baskets? You had Better Things, Take.
Oh, yeah.
And then his show, which he released. I don't know how you would say it, just shows up in your email one day.
But now it's on Hulu. Now it's on Hulu.
And, you know, it's, you know, you go to his website to watch him, but Alan Alda is in it and Buscemi is in it. And it was really an interesting.
It was an interesting thing.
Yeah.
I don't know. I still don't know what to make of it, but I was just like, it's cool that he did that.
It's amazingly cool. And the first one I saw, I'm like, is this a play? Are we seeing something that he's going to put on Broadway? And then I remember the tone of the second one was much different. And by the time you got to that crazy Laurie Metcalf thing, that was like one of the best things that I've ever seen. And I'm like, I don't know what this is. Yeah. And then the way it ended, I'm like, I'm not sure. Is this a dream sequence? But that it's an amazing thing that you see somebody and you know that he's working it out.
Yeah.
He was doing jokes from that week in the middle of this thing.
It was like he, I don't know why, he built a lot of rules into what he wanted this thing to be.
Yeah.
That was all in his head. You know, he wrote some of it ahead of time, but it's like, no, I got to leave this open so we can talk about current events, which is a wide. I think that's almost like when they have hostages hold up the newspaper.
Yeah, right.
Like, I think he just wanted to prove that they shot it that week.
And it was exciting in the moment. It was, at the time that was coming out, an incredibly kind of, oh, my God, so that had to be Tuesday.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you were doing it. Now, but you're right. If you're watching it on Hulu, that doesn't mean anything to
that
you.
That reference is now dated, even though he tried to do it the week of. But, it was interesting to be that idea, especially when you're in New York. You're like, oh, like, he's shooting that right now, like a block from here. But, yeah, it was you know, it wasn't very funny other than when it was made, but it was an interesting thing that, you know, and exciting that as, you know, one of the two, three biggest comedians working, that this is how he spends his time. It's like a very good role model to have. To
not only spends his time, but his money. Yeah. He takes the profit and puts it into something that is, you know, somewhat avant-garde. There's no doubt about it. But at the same time that that's happening, if you go and watch network TV, Modern Family or Big Bang, it's still very much in that same 70s tradition, which is not easy to do either. I mean, people can bust balls, but to pack 93 jokes in 24 minutes with seven characters, there's craft to that.
Yeah. No, I mean, I love that stuff. And I do think, and the thing is, like, there's now so many TV shows that I haven't watched, shows that I like I like Modern Family, but I haven't watched in years. But you know, a lot of people had to get in a room and they had a debate, which is the best way to set this up. And, you know, especially Modern Family has always been like a very big onus was put on like being a strong joke show, but there's a million shows.
Yeah.
Like, so this fall was the year when it's like, when Better Things, Atlanta, Tig's show premiered. There's a few others. Like, there's now too many comedy shows. Before, there's just too many shows.
Right.
But like now, as a person who writes about comedy, I'm like, this is too many. Literally, it's not. There's no people that can consume all of this, and it's all good. Like, it, which is a weird thing to be like complaining about, but it's just like an unreal thing that the entertainment industry has been able to do, and it's a testament to how many interesting, smart, comedic voices kind of have come up in this generation where, you know, Donald was always a person, especially when he was in New York, that people knew was very talented. I remember my friend saying he was the best improviser in New York when he was still doing improv. And then, you know, he had that show on he wrote for 30 Rock. Then he was on Community and you're like, yeah, he's good. And then he like, you know, Atlanta came out and you're like, oh, he was like a serious artist this whole time.
Yeah.
And it's great. And I think it is exciting. It is amazing. You know, as we said, 100 specials. There's now like a million TV shows. And then you're like, oh, you forget that there hasn't been that many comedy movies that anyone saw.
Right. I can't think of one that really.
Well, I love Popstar. Popstar was like.
Popstar was your.
Everything.
It was your everything.
But otherwise.
Yeah.
I mean, like you know, like Will Ferrell didn't put out like his own movie this year.
Yeah.
And Adam Sandler's movies are on Netflix.
Yeah, he went away somewhere. You know, he's on Netflix. And it looks like it to me. You know what I mean? Like, he has the stars, but it doesn't feel like it was a movie that played in the theaters and now is on Netflix.
Yeah. And like Kevin James's movie was on Netflix?
Yeah, it was on Netflix too. I think I started it one night, but it's nothing against him. But just like you said, if something doesn't grab you immediately, you just move on to the next thing. And let's, you know, Atlanta has heat, but if this came out 5 years ago, it would, well, anybody was talking about. Same with Better Things.
Yeah.
It has heat, but that would have been considered the breakthrough, you know, top 1%. And I don't know.
The only show people would talk about. And now it's like, if anything, I feel like half people have seen Better Things, half people saw Atlanta, and they'll be like, I'll get to the other one next.
I know. That's the way I am. I was more Better Things in Atlanta, but I'm like, I'll get into Atlanta. It's not as personal as it used to be when you're like, I won't watch that show. You know, there was always shows that you would point out to yourself, I'm not watching that show ever. But these days, you're just like, I'll take a weekend and I'll go all through his life's work and be done with it. You know, you write about sketch comedy. I think probably still one of the toughest things to pull off is a good sketch. It can be very embarrassing when it doesn't work.
Well, that's why, and that's part of why SNL is so fun, is that when it doesn't work, you still get to watch it. Like, you still get to see it not work. And that's part of it. You know, I always think it's like watching sports. It's like watching a professional sports, watching SNL, which is like when they, especially the live sketches, when they succeed, part of it is that it's funny, but part of it's like, they did that like this week.
Yeah.
And when it fails, you're like, well, they tried this week. But it is hard to write things that are both funny and also have, like, feel like a whole thing. Mm-hmm. You know, like, a lot of sketches can get a good joke in, but, like, the idea that you can have good jokes, but also it feels like a unit of an idea, not just, like, a thing thrown together.
Yeah.
And, you know, the top sketch of the year that I picked was this sketch called Wells for Boys from SNL, which... It's this, I believe it's this writer, Julio Torres' idea. He's a New York comedian, and he wrote it with another writer there, Jeremy Baylor, I think his name is. But Julio's gotten sketches on every week. He's a new writer who has a very bizarre voice. It's, you know, it's very quiet and it's tonal. And, but he's getting things every week, which is interesting. You know, he had this one about a sink, which was just a sink with a voiceover. It was, and then he did the next week he had one, which was like almost like a sequel, which was Dave Chappelle voicing a painting of a swan.
Yeah.
So then you see like, oh, cool. He does that. And then you see him kind of come into his own at SNL of like getting that tone, but writing skits like Wells for Boys, which was like a very specific observation, but like also had really, really funny hard jokes in it.
But still reminds you of the weird kid from school where you're like, wow, no one hangs out with him, but I saw this project. It's really good. Yeah. You know?
And you're like, you, and that was nice about that, that sketch. It was short, but the, in it, you captured this guy's, this character's entire life. You're like, in the future, you're going to have like a, you're going to move to a major city and your life's going to be really good. And you're going to be have like a, you'll be an artist, but right now it's going to be hard for you, but you have this well for you to look at. And so that was great. There was that, a Portlandia sketch where it was all in sign language for no reason. It wasn't not about, it was just like it was in sign language.
Still the weirdest show, the Portlandia.
It can get so...
Yeah.
When, you know, they can really go sideways.
Well, I love that, you know, like you said, he gets off and does that. And that documentary now show is in between Why Are They Wasting Their Time? And This Is the Greatest Thing I've Ever Seen during the same show.
I think that, and that's like a classic Seth thing, which is like part of the joke is this is like what grown men did on their vacation.
Yeah.
Because Seth, they all have like careers.
Yeah.
And this is not it. So you're like, and literally Seth writes the show when he has vacation. Like he does not like it. So
sad when you think about that. Yeah, but it's the saddest thing.
Thankfully you can write quickly. But like, you know, like the, when they did the parody of Jiro Dreams of Sushi, Juan likes rice and chicken. Like really it was written over a week. Yeah. And then like, you know, they all went to Colombia and they had to shoot it in the jungle. Apparently it was not easy to do, but it is a perfect parody. It's really funny, but you're also like, why would you get the right like lens that they used to, that's like,
yeah,
you hear the directors talk about it and everything they shoot, they like, oh, they try to find the cameras from that era, they try to find like, you know, the color palette, all that type of stuff, and the same editing technology.
When only a small percentage of this country saw the original film.
Yeah, I think Salesman was one they parodied this
Yes.
week, which is funny because it's also the Bob Oden, the Mr. Show Redux or whatever, also parodied Salesman.
Yeah.
So this documentary that I think now the only people I've seen are these 10 comedy writers, has now been on two prominent sketch series. I think like they did a very thorough parody of Spalding Gray.
Unbelievable.
What, and you're like, who is that for? It's like it was written by John Mulaney for John Mulaney.
I know, but you know what? Mulaney was in here, and I was saying when that thing came on TV years ago, I watched it over and over.
Yeah.
And mainly because somebody was doing that in New York. It was a real New York fantasy of, you leave your apartment, you walk down the street to some shitty black box, and then you do it. And this year when... I went to see Chris do his suicide thing. I was thinking the same thing. I was thinking like, oh my God, he's living the Spalding Gray life. Yeah. He's talking about his problems.
Yeah. But Spalding had the all, you know, like Chris is still, it's
stand-up-y,
where Spalding had all of this, like things, you know, he's sitting OCD, at his desk and he's pulling the mask. Yeah. Like there's all this shtick that he was doing that made it like a perfect thing for John Mulaney to, where it's like over, like, intellectual in a way that's like very silly in a very New York way. But I remember when I saw that, I was like, one, it's an incredible performance that Bill gives.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we, New York Magazine actually had a screening of the series or a couple episodes. And so at the party, I think I was talking to the editors and they're like, it was the most unreal thing I've ever worked on. It could, cause for, I mean, I think for the first 10 minutes, it's just like Bill doing a monologue.
Mm-hmm.
Like he had to memorize a full monologue, and again, on his vacation from being a movie star.
Right. And he's doing it somewhat in the inflections, but not directly dead on. So it was really like, oh, he could have probably been just this done, guy. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, if he wasn't, you know, if he wasn't a movie star, this may be where exactly where his weird career would yeah. be right now.
I think a lot of comedians could sit down at a desk. I mean, like, it's, you know, a lot of people now going to a stool.
Mm-hmm.
I think we should bring back a desk comedian.
I would love to see it. Just somebody so formal. But I remember that that whole thing always had a Talking Heads feel about yeah. it for me. You know, when you're seeing that kind of a genius, weird, straight
yeah, yeah.
dude, you know. But look at Oh Hello being a hit on Broadway.
That was the best.
A sketch that, yeah. you know, from a basic cable is selling out for big money. And it's stunning.
That is the most unreal thing as a person who's been covering like this era of comedy mm-hmm. that they could take a thing that they did in a gross bar that is now a Buffalo Exchange in the East Village.
Yeah.
And they just did some bit to host a show and now it's a Broadway show.
A Broadway show with jokes that you'd have to pretty much live fairly yeah. close to that yeah. theater to get.
Yeah. I mean, I've seen the show. I saw it when it was off Broadway. I saw it in Montreal
mm-hmm.
and they kind of got it, but they didn't get it as deeply to, I think people who are not in New York don't realize how almost unheightened those characters sometimes
yes.
can feel. Like
yes.
they feel like real people. And then the jokes are the best jokes in yeah. there is in town. They're not even just in town. I don't think there's been a thing that has more hard, funny jokes than that I've seen. I don't know if ever.
No, you're right. And like you said, they feel like real people. I literally have friends that they remember. You know what I mean? I'm at the point in my life now that show's a little bit uncomfortable, you know, because I'm like, are we laughing at Steely Dan? Because I've been to all those shows at the Beacon. You know, I'm not sure if I'm a punchline here. And that's the greatest. Yeah. That's the greatest. But, you know, to do that when you're at your career, when they're at this point yeah. where you're risking,
yeah.
you know, this major flop, you know,
yeah.
and I'm always stunned. You know, Mulaney had that show that didn't work for him
mm-hmm.
on NBC. And I thought it showed an interesting side of him of how he took it too. Yeah. You know, like he was kind of pissed and kind of feeling like he didn't get the shot yeah. that he deserved.
Yeah, it was. I think you know, I've talked to him a couple times after, and I did the first longer interview right after, mm-hmm. or like a couple months after, and he kind of goes in waves. I think he acknowledged it didn't work, but didn't like. Ultimately, I think he's like, these shows are impossible to do,
mm-hmm.
and if they don't start off good, you can't fix it.
You can't fix it at all.
I remember his quote was before it got canceled. He's like, look, it's not canceled, but I know what usually happens to shows that no one watched, that no one likes, and yeah. critics also hate.
Yeah, he knows that game. But also, like, I saw those guys a couple times over the past year, and they off stage,
yeah.
and they're just exhausted. And you're like, these dudes are a lot more ambitious than they state. I mean, to yeah. be able to get this stuff done is long, hard days every day.
Yeah, you know? I mean, they've been touring the show like the Marx Brothers were.
Yes,
like,
the Marx Brothers is perfect.
But it's like a road show where the, you know, like I saw it a year before the Broadway one, and you know, it's almost like a lot of the setups were the same, but none of the punchlines were the same.
Yeah,
or like completely, you know, it was essentially like they completely took things in and out. You know, there's so many jokes for certain setups at this point that a lot of the script just says, you know, Steely Dan joke. And
right.
Whatever one they want to do the yeah, night of,
that's funny.
They just like, Nick will be like, oh, I'll do this one yeah. of the six that we have. You know, it's the amount of comedy they put into that thing for, you know, it'll be interesting to see if they film it because they did it, right?
Right.
Like, it feels like they need to because, like, it's such a beautiful thing that they created. But what if they don't? It's almost like, oh, it's like a happening that comedy had this very specific run of things.
Right.
And it's a landmark moment for their careers, but not necessarily something that they have to try to even take to like a mainstream thing, because it is a thing where you wonder once it really is a mainstream thing where people are like, why, what, who, how? Yeah.
But there is almost yeah. There is a modern version of a Woody Allen or even a Mike Myers-ness
yeah.
to that, you know?
Yeah.
But I was thinking, even as you were talking, that we have these when you look at how many of these performers are connected now, you know, you have like Louis in the set of one universe and Apatow in the set of another one. And then Seth is. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think there's, you know, it's people like people that work at SNL in the like after 2000 like each other. Right.
Right.
So then and they don't work together because they know it could they can get the movie made like the guys in the first generation. Like these are also his friends. Like I think Seth was an executive producer on Popstar partly because he probably would like for fun read the scripts and be like, I'll give notes. Because Andy also was like the best man at his wedding, or he was like, or if you know, like these guys are friends. You look even, like you know, Oh Hello has those guests every night, and if you know at the beginning of some theater people, but then it was mostly just comedy people that you don't know they know, but kind of like I think what a lot of comedy people realize is like this is a special thing that's not tarnished by the industry at all, so everyone then. Was excited to come, you know, all the late nights, all the, you know, Seth came, but also Colbert came and he was on, you know, usually those segments are like 10 minutes and he apparently Colbert, they did like 30 to 45 minutes.
Mm-hmm. You riff on Broadway too, you know,
it's like an unusual, you know, Alan Alda did it twice.
Yeah.
He didn't know what it was before. And then I went to the opening night in it. So I sat next to Alan Alda. And it was an interesting thing where you can tell he didn't know exactly what he was there for, but he knew he was going to come on stage. And I was like, well, I wonder if he's going to like it. And then immediately he loved it so much.
Right.
And he's like, it's so funny. And and I think it's like a comedy likes when good comedy things are happening.
Sure.
Which is why people that you don't think they know. And I think, you know, Judd's good at connecting people. And I think, you know, all these stand-up shows, people are appearing in other people's shows and they keep on coming up and podcasts, everyone's appearing on different podcasts. It definitely is seemingly a lot less lonely than when the 1980s comedy boom where everyone just kind of like went off on their own.
Well, I think also those people knew there were only so many slots, you know, so... You know, Kinison was always looking over at Dice and Bobcat and like, who's going to be the weirdo of this time? And I don't think Bill Murray always was like, oh, I hope Dan Aykroyd gets the best stand. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I think they all wanted to make sure at the end of the day that they were winning, where now you're not going to get the one big thing, but you get eight nice size things.
Yeah. And I think, and the more that, you appear on each other's things, the more those nice size things seem, you know, marketable or whatever for like TV shows. I remember like if you almost any stand-up comedian has a special out on Twitter, almost any comedian who you don't think know each other.
Right.
Be like, oh, this is like one of the funniest guys I know. I'm so happy with the special out. And you're like, and not even like, oh, I saw it. I'm just like, hey, you might not know this person, but you know me, so you should. And that is very different than there's only one slot. But again, that's because there's 100 stand-up specials instead of the one HBO does.
I always find it funny when the real left-wing guys still support the real right-wing guys. They're like, I don't really agree with him, but he's hilarious, so check him out.
Can you think that seems to happen. I wonder if that's going to happen less now. If it's
because
like,
of the Trump thing?
Yeah, if they're going to be like, it was fun while it lasted, but now... Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, the fact that you can't make it through any day without talking about Trump.
Yeah.
You can't make it through any show.
I thought we were going to get through this episode
We came very, very close. But, you know, I hear, particularly in the women.
Yeah.
I was listening to the Gail Meets Girls and hearing Lisa Traeger go into a rant like I'd never heard. And Annie Lienerman was on there and just, you could hear like brokenness with women that I don't think me and you could pick up on.
No, and I think that will make it hard for like a male stand-up comedian to do right-leaning material in that way in mainstream clubs. If there's a lot of people that you're going to get off stage and they're going to look at you and be like, and maybe they won't say anything, but they'll look at you in a way that you're like, this is not worth it. But it'll be interesting for those people who try to do Trump jokes that are not necessarily, like, you know, the joke is probably, like, kind of ironic supporting him or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, Bill Burr might do a thing where, like, I like the guy for these reasons. I don't think he should be president. Like, Michael Che does it a lot.
Yeah.
Like, I'd like to hang out with the guy. I don't think he should be president. It'll be interesting to see how those type of jokes fly, where it's not necessarily pro him, but, like, is not only negative him.
Well, I think people have finally gotten around to, like, I can't believe a dude lives like this. You know what I mean? Like, in the same way of, like, they've held up Kanye for so many years. You know what I mean? Like, well, that was crazy, and he's going to do something crazier tomorrow, yeah, so we won't be able to hang on to it. But it also goes to show, when you look at the late night people who,
yeah,
you know, at a certain point even stopped making jokes and were just begging people not to do it, and it still happened,
yeah,
let you know that the culture war is not what we thought it was.
Yeah, it's not really a war. It's like two people yelling and, like, on different planes. Like,
right.
Like, people are, like, talking, and it's like they're talking different languages. Like,
yeah.
And it's getting to a point where it almost is like we're talking different languages, where we have different meanings for certain words, and each people will take it different ways. But ultimately, we're not having – it's just a late-night show is talking to whatever their audience is, and probably if it's – if they are a late night show that talks about left leaning politics all the time, they're going to have left leaning audiences. But it was interesting. And to be fair, I think Jon Stewart used to talk as if he would be humble, but he'd act a little bit like he had an influence on the greater good, where, you know, Seth is like, I have no impact.
Yeah.
You know, Seth was like, you know, it's catharsis at best. And Sam B was the same thing, which is like, I think their shows are good, but how can we, this person is the president. Like, we can't really do much other than, like, kind of over time paint what the president is.
And yet that guy just had a show a couple years ago. I mean, the reason why he's the president is because he had a show.
Yeah, he had a Comedy Central roast.
Yeah. And by the way, this is when they keep saying reality star. No, that was just a game show.
Yeah.
Like any other game show.
Yeah.
And
he's a game show host.
Yeah. And he's the president now, so you can't play down the point of politics and social media and all that. Well, dude, it's always great to see you, and I'm very, very happy for you. Plug away, would you, Chris?
Jesse David Fox has been in studio. Jesse is the senior comedy editor at Vulture.com. You can read his recent articles, the 20 best sketches of 2016 and the 10 best comedy specials of 2016 at Vulture.com. On Twitter, it's at Jesse David Fox, and his podcast coming out in February. It might be called Good Ones, a podcast about jokes.
All right, we'll see you next time.
I see you.
It's the Bennington Show. Gail's off today for a funeral. We've been hanging out, and we're expecting Dan Soder to stop by today.
Yes, Dan Soder should be here any moment.
He's from the Bonfire. Chris, you wanted to say something about a shirt that you've been trying to sell for Christmas, and this is pathetic that Chris tries to get involved in selling a shirt every Christmas.
Well, it's the Trump Cuck t-shirt, Ron, and it's available on theinterrabang.com. Double XL's already sold out, so we want everyone to go to theinterrabang.com to purchase their Trump Cuck shirt before it is sold out. It's the perfect Christmas gift for someone in your family or yourself.
Are you doing any of the Trump Cuck videos or anything anymore?
Oh, yeah, there'll be periscoping of the Trump Cucking, yes.
Try to get into the tower tonight, would you?
You think I should just make a run for it?
I think they would let you. I think they'd be glad to see everybody else has gotten in.
Right? I mean, like Elon Musk
and
got
try
in.
Try to get an interview at Fox. Go over and see what it takes to get an interview at Fox.
I'm going to try to run into Shepard Smith today.
You've been saying that every day for 3 weeks.
I don't know. I don't know if they put him out on in other cities or what he's doing.
They put him out in other cities. What's he trying to say? Do you know, Jen?
Remotes?
No, you've seen his show. He doesn't do remotes. He's the anchor.
It's funny because yesterday when me and Vito were going downstairs to the stand, mm-hmm. we ran into Newt Gingrich. How do you say his last?
We didn't run into Newt Gingrich.
We
saw him from our cab. There was no run. Like,
literally, we were running to our cab, and he was like running to his, like, I guess, car behind us.
Yes, he has an actual car. He doesn't need a crabby yellow cab. Well, that's a nice sighting. I don't know. He's another guy that Trump has kind of left behind, right? He didn't get any of the gigs that he thought. Anybody that kind of helped Trump in the beginning doesn't get. I saw that they're talking about Christie putting out a book.
Oh shit!
Which is just hilarious. And they're like, "You're the governor now. You can't use this time to sell a book." So he goes, "I'm just going to sell Trump cuck shirts." Then I don't care either hey, way.
Christie, that's my thing. You see that Trump purposely didn't invite the dude from Twitter, the Twitter CEO.
Yeah,
because when during the election, he wanted the Twitter people to give him his own personal emoji for the hashtag crooked Hillary. And they say, no, we're not going to do that for you. So now he has a grudge against the guy who runs Twitter.
He is. He holds a grudge like a New Yorker. I give him credit for that. Let's see. What else? No, last night was the end of the 33rd season of Survivor.
33 seasons?
Yeah, because they do two seasons a year. Still. And it's been like 16 years.
I saw the first two seasons. And I don't think I ever, I don't think I stuck with it.
Well, you've been missing it, my friend. There's been 30 winners.
I've heard about this Boston Rob guy.
Don't no, they? That's 10 years ago. That's literally 10 years ago.
He's their Dr. Will.
Some guy last night, his mom died from cancer, and she died just as he came back from Survivor.
Oh.
And, no one could not vote for this terrible person. He's kind of a terrible guy, but they had to give it to him anyway.
You got the mom vote.
Yeah.
Good for him. What did they give away? $1 million on that show?
$1 million. Sweet mil.
That's nice.
Was this the millennial season?
Millennials versus Gen X's.
Who won, millennial or Gen X?
Well, the fact is, I think the two generations learned to love each other. You know what I mean? They, you know what? They laughed, they cried, and they learned a little bit.
I've only seen one season of Survivor, and it was with that crazy dude who was in the military named Phil, who didn't seem like he actually was in the military.
And what was he at the end of the day?
I think he was in the military, but he was like, he was fucking psychotic.
You're psychotic, Vito.
Thank you.
It's not a good thing.
We should play Survivor here. How many cookies did you make it through?
I got an even fucking dozen. I'm down so to my bakers. More.
Mm.
That's good.
That's the end of your first 13.
Well, first,
and
what?
We move on to the second platform.
I can't get to another 13, man. I mean, my stomach is just full.
Okay, dude, just relax. No one's making you do anything.
I said I was going to do a bigger dozen.
By the way, I don't know why you can't do that with a beverage. Like, you don't have any milk or anything. You just go dry.
I had some water, but ran out.
So then you have no water. Just like you had some money and it ran out. You've got none.
Happens every week.
Jen, let me ask you this. Vito and Chris are both drowning. You have a boat oar. Do you give it to one of them to pull themselves into the boat? Do you pull the boat oar up so neither one of them can get into the boat? Or do you start swinging at them with the boat oar, trying to hit them in the head?
I'll try to save one of them.
Which one?
What do you say?
That one's tough. It depends
it
what day
tough.
Or
it's Vito.
Today.
Why is it always Vito?
No, sometimes, you know.
She even said she's not close with you. She's close with Vito.
I'm just with Vito more than Chris.
I build alliances.
You do build alliances.
I do it with the interns. I do it with coworkers.
By the way, I looked over the top 10 that we were doing with our guests today. He picked his top 10 specials. And the iBang has done their top 10 specials, and only one makes both lists.
Really?
Is that amazing? Yeah.
It's crazy.
Just Ali Wong makes both lists. I might be wrong. Maybe Reggie Watts, too.
I loved Ali Wong's.
Yeah, I was crazy about her, too. When's Pete Holmes doing his show?
I believe January is when it comes out.
And the name of it is What's Up, Holmes? Is that the name of it? Because I think that would have been good. I think that would have been good. Come in, my friend. I got a big star. A big star here from Billions.
Dance Order's coming in the studio.
Right here. Yeah. Dance right when I walk in. Yeah. You're a super fan, Ron. Benson.
I really am. By the way, cool shirt.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And I don't know whether you met Jen. She's Jen is our new producer, and but when I was talking to her about Billions, she's a giant fan of yours from Billions.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
You like my acting work in Billions?
It is. Really
you
good.
Do right now. You look like such an acting coach.
I want to be
that walking in with the facial hair. Yeah.
Well, the thing is, I want to be an acting coach without ever acting myself.
Isn't that most of them? I don't
acting
know.
Acting is lying. Remember that. Acting is lying.
Yeah, why do you think I can do it?
Yeah, you are natural.
Yeah.
But let me just say this, and we'll get it out of the way. The Bonfire is a real radio show, not a podcast, and I'm just going to say that, my friend.
Are you serious?
Yes, yes.
Are you serious?
Yes, I've been enjoying.
Thank you. We started doing show prep.
Mm-hmm. It shows. And the other thing I noticed the
other day, it's a real game changer. Doing work is a real thing.
And you know, no podcast has ever done prep. They just, you know.
I think that's why podcasts are so appealing. It's like you just get, it's like City League basketball.
Okay.
But then you can go pro from it. No one's saying you can't go
pro.
No
one ever has, though.
What, podcast-wise?
Have you ever played, I don't think they move over into, like, say, terrestrial.
Oh.
But did you play Catholic League basketball when you were here, the CYO leagues?
Just baseball CYO.
You didn't grow up Catholic, right?
No.
The CYO would always be Catholic basketball. And the great thing about it is that they would set up things with such low ceilings that everybody would shoot bricks. And then when you're somewhere else, you're still just shooting with no arc whatsoever. Because this would be as big as the room that they would set up.
It's in a conference room, not an actual gym.
Exactly.
So you get that Sean Marion shot where it just comes right off your chest. The grossest shot in the history of the NBA. I played like City League and I was just terrible.
Yeah. Well, you're supposed to be terrible when you're kids. I mean, very few people are good at anything. That's what I like to point out.
But there is that group of little kids who like had abs and can do backflips. There was always like one or two of them.
Those kids grew up to be 4 or 5. That's the thing. They have control over their little body. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I feel so powerful.
Yeah, and then by the time they're a senior, they can't make any team. Yeah. They're tiny. So never feel good if your kid is 8 and a good athlete. You're like, he's peaking.
I was like, I've got the number one Little League player. Yeah. And you're like, well, that might be about it.
Oh, boy. He's throwing a curve at 11. Not going to play it very long.
Yeah, you don't realize that peaking in your teenage years is a disaster because you're just left with your adulthood. Like, it's frustrating when you're a teenager and, like, no one likes me. This sucks.
Right.
And then you go from a former personality. Your 20s suck a little less. And you start, like, I'm in my 30s now and I'm like, I like people.
Yeah,
I'm good, Stuart Smalley. I'm great enough. But teenage years, those kids that were like cool, you see them now, you're like, hey bud,
you don't think that you were cool when you were a teenager?
No, I think I did drugs and I made people laugh, so people kept me around, but that's I don't think I was cool.
That's cool. If you do drugs and you make people laugh, I think it's cool.
Yeah,
I do.
I just thought it was like a way to make friends.
Yeah. That's what happens when you're cool. Chris, would you have said that you were cool when you were a kid?
Oh, God, no. No.
And not now?
Not even a shot.
No.
God, no. I take that back. Chris Stanley has a gravity to him.
Yeah, he does.
He goes outside. People go outside. He goes to a corner of the room.
They follow him. But Big J did not introduce him on a show, and it hurt him very badly. Over what show were you doing with him?
It was Legion of Skanks,
and it was when they had another guest.
Mickey Gall came.
So,
now listen, I get it. I get why Chris is upset.
Yeah.
It's just disrespectful to not be introduced on a podcast you're on.
Yeah,
but also knowing those three guys, they were probably just all
stoked,
gussied up.
Yeah.
Gomez was losing his shit.
He's talking in the mirror in the bathroom. Do this, Lewis. It's all right. Just look him in the eye. Treat him like any other man.
Yeah, and that kid is a kid, by the way, that Mickey Gall. He's just a young baby face guy. I'm worried about him.
I love him.
Yeah.
He's fighting this Saturday. Sage Northcutt. I hope he beats the shit out of him.
That fucking guy's a Nazi that he's fighting. I don't care what anybody says.
He does look like he also looks like a human Japanese anime cartoon.
Yeah.
With the hair.
But. Yeah, he does. He looks, but always the bad guy.
He is definitely a bad guy.
Yeah. Oh, God. That kid can't be beat.
Wow. He's Goku.
Yeah, that's what
fucking Dragon Ball.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to tape this, but not watch it live, because I won't be able to stand it if our boy gets beat up.
I don't like that.
I don't like the separating of the elbows.
Yeah. He does like a lot of Sage Northcutt guy does like a lot of like weird flying kicks, but I just like Mickey Gall's like, I'm gonna beat the shit out of him.
Yeah, Mickey,
I just like that jersey, I'm gonna knock him right in this fucking mouth.
Look at this fucking kid.
Yeah.
That's frightening.
That's a guy, if you saw him on the first day of school, you'd be like, this is going to be a long year.
Yeah.
He's going to somehow intimidate me.
That's the guy that you're like, you show up with your friends and weapons. You know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, that's the thing I didn't realize. I think
that kind of guy is a wait till he's sleeping kind of guy.
Well, yeah. But then you just...
you give him the soap in the pillowcase.
I didn't realize that other people didn't fight that way. And I'm working in a carnival up in Canada. It was like right after. And there was this guy that wanted to fight one of our friends that was part of our crew. And I'm like, I'm sitting there with these Canadians. I'm like, don't worry about it. When he shows up, there's fucking seven of us. He's fucking dead. We're going to kick him until he's dead. And the Canadian kids were like, that's not fair. And I go, what are you talking about fair? What do you mean when you're saying fair? Yeah. It's fair to watch our friend get beat up?
No, we all put our collective possessions in a pile safely. Someone watches them. We go to a very cleared off room where no one can get corners or anything. You get the first punch, then he punches. They're like, do old warfare.
Yeah.
Ha! Ha! That's a Canadian fist fight.
And it was like embarrassing to me that six
you're
people.
Such a Philly shithead.
Yeah, so, yeah, that people are going, how is that fair, Ron?
Stop.
And I go, why would we be fair to some fucking guy that wants to beat up our friend?
Yeah.
He's that's a dick.
It's completely understandable. Seven on one.
Yeah, 7-on-1. This is great.
Yeah.
The way this is working out.
Beat that. Yeah, the wind's blowing your way.
Like, yeah. And they live by a different code.
Yeah.
And then, quite frankly, looked at me in a whole different way.
You went from being like fun to possibly terrifying.
But yeah, it came across to them like there was something. Well, because we were in Canada, I was the closest they saw to a black person ever in their lives. You know what I mean?
Because you had been around black people.
Oh, yeah. I get it.
You're the reason they lock their doors at night.
Canadians don't lock their doors. They feel that comfortable with each other. They leave their keys in their car. They leave their doors open.
That's fucking cool.
The only thing they put away is their skates. They put their skates away every night. It's just being a good Canadian.
In a gun safe?
Yeah.
Just heavy duty safe.
I only found out yesterday that guy, America's dad, died playing hockey. It's age 69.
Alan Thicke did?
Alan Thicke was playing hockey with his kid and died. And then he also, they said when they were taking him to the hospital, he has to have some pictures taken. I guess he didn't think it was going to go that bad.
Oh,
and he was like,
shit.
Get some shots of me. Leaving.
Oh, so he didn't die on the ice.
No, he didn't die
on
the ice.
I thought he would have, like, Gordie Howed it, like, just shot out, taking the shot, flying, and then he just lands. And
that would have been beautiful.
Just a hump, just like a mass.
Laid out like that, 90 degrees.
Yeah. And then he's just crumbled in the corner of the ice rink. Hey, Dad?
Dad?
That's, I bet a lot of people have heart attacks on ice. Like,
imagine.
Guys who play hockey, they just keep playing it in different leagues.
Yeah, they don't stop until their little hearts give out. But I guess it was a way,
just
you know.
Keep playing their hearts. They just play a little heart out.
Yeah. And Chris, you always said you wanted to die the way you live, taking drugs.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's the only way I should end, Ron.
He would have loved to have OD'd.
Do you have like a leaving Las Vegas scenario? Like how you'd go out?
Probably like booze and pills.
But here's the deal. Most people were like, oh, I'm going to kill myself and do it fast. Instead of doing that, leaving Las Vegas, which is, it looks like a pretty fun out.
Yes. And the second I even considered suicide, I would start smoking cigarettes again.
Sure.
Oh, yeah.
Just that's the long game.
Yeah. Right.
Might as well get that enjoyment.
Yeah.
amazing.
Oh, the thought of buying a pack of Camel Lights and then just cracking that first one and being like, well, fuck you, life.
I win.
Yeah.
You'll go out content. He died content.
Yeah.
Smoking a Camel Light.
This is the weather that makes me want to smoke the most, when it's brutally cold out.
Isn't that funny, too? That is an interesting thing. When it's cold, you want to smoke.
I found the same thing, because I quit whatever, like 8 months ago or whatever. And when it got cold out, I'm like, holy shit, I really need a cigarette.
I also consider this brown liquid time. I think you want to have a brown alcohol this time of year.
Scotch.
Whiskey.
Is it scotch?
Scotch, bourbon. Scotch and bourbon.
I'm a Jameson. Just the thought of Jameson.
Nice Irish whiskey. It is an Irish whiskey time of year.
Yeah.
Which was the standard Christmas present in my neighborhood. Everybody, all the neighbors would give you Irish whiskey as you gave them Irish whiskey.
What kind did you give out?
Well, it was Jameson's, Tillamore Dew, and there was one other. It's been a long time since I drank. There was one other I can't think of off the top of my head.
Tullamore Dew, Jameson, and why am I not thinking of this? It's the Protestant whiskey.
Cutty Sark?
No.
We don't drink Protty whiskey.
Yeah, exactly. That's the whole thing. Even Bushmills.
Bushmills. Is that Protestant?
Yeah, I think so.
I did not know that.
I think Protestant's Bushmills and Catholic is Jameson. Because my mom's Irish Catholic. I wasn't raised Irish Catholic because she didn't want to do that to me.
Right.
But she was, and all of her family is.
Well, then she's in hell now for not taking care of you.
She is alive.
Yeah, but I mean...
Oh, mentally in hell?
Yeah,
well, I think she had that when I was born.
Yeah. But I'm stunned that Bushmills is Protestant. I'm fucking literally stunned.
I don't know if that's a soda fact. Can you look that up? Sometimes I just say shit with confidence because I've smoked so much pot, I just believe it to be true. I will it to be true.
I've never even known for any product to take a religion like that. It's kind of interesting. We're a Protestant whiskey. Yeah.
Do you believe in a different God? Then drink a different poison.
Because I think that a lot of Irish would just become Protestants if they... Yeah.
Can I tell you where I learned it?
Yeah.
The Wire.
Okay, that makes sense.
Because he's at... McNulty? McNulty goes, I don't drink that Protestant shit.
It is Protestant.
Yeah! Yeah. Soda no willed one, it.
No one in my fucking neighborhood knows this.
Is that, would that be a big deal?
Oh, yeah, and we drank a lot of Bushmills too. The first night I was ever busted, we were drinking Bushmills. I think I was 15 or 16 years old. It was literally St. Patrick's Day. And we were walking back. It was me, Smitty, Wardy, and Danny Archdeacon. And Smitty gets the idea of punching... mailboxes, right? So he's just coming up and he fucking punches the mailbox and we're all laughing. So we get to the next mailbox and somebody punches it. And the cop, he was an unbelievable detective. He just followed all these broken mailboxes until he got to us.
You guys let a bread trail.
Yeah.
We left a broken mailbox bread trail.
We thought it was the perfect crime, but we didn't realize somebody could keep But literally, the confidence of not having a care in the world of like, hey, someone's going to call the cops here.
It's weird how like you and your friends do that in Philadelphia, then in the suburbs of Denver, me and my friends drank like a bottle of Jaeger. Meister, and we thought it'd be fun to tackle real estate signs.
Oh yeah. So that was our good.
And then you don't realize like real estate signs sometimes are really in the ground.
Oh yeah,
like,
yeah, they're
deep.
Yeah.
And you put a shoulder and a head like a football tackle, and then you're like, boom, and just go into it, or just take half of it out.
But when you look back on those memories, you realize why the Cambodia could put together Khmer Rouge, because there's nothing as vicious and stupid as young men. It's just the dumbest thing ever. And they would have handed you machine guns and said, go shoot up the other town. We would have done it in a heartbeat.
Six shots of Jaeger?
Yeah.
I would have been raging. And Metallica, if they would have put on, like, Ride the Lightning and given me Jaeger, I'd be like, I will off everyone. Yeah, that's a very good point, man. It's just, yeah, teenage boys are shitheads.
That's why they draft them. They draft people that age. You don't draft somebody who's 30 because if somebody who's 30 is going, why should we take that hill?
Oh, me and
guns
me,
up there.
Yeah, me and the way I love my life now.
Yeah.
Like, I just started a garden out on my stoop.
There's no reason to take the hill. We're safer here.
It doesn't matter.
Have you thought about diplomacy?
Yeah.
What are they going through?
Yeah, and then, you know, those fucking, when you're fucking 18, honor!
Give me a knife and a six shooter.
This is fucking awesome! Yeah.
That's what it is. Don't draft old men.
Don't
Or just have wars with old men and there'd be less wars.
Yes, it would be guys.
If it's illegal for young men to go to war, like under 25, you're like, you can't. You're just too rammed up.
Yeah.
Just too ramped up. We can't do it.
But they're the only ones that will follow orders. And you see this in professional football. You have these giant guys getting screamed at by little white guys. Just fucking...
Trashed.
I'm sorry, coach.
Yeah.
I'm fucking sorry.
But some of those guys, especially in the NFL, college, I think it works more because, like, Harbaugh for the Niners, he just grated on them. Because these are grown men who are millionaires. And he's like, do you want to play for this system? And they're like, shut up, man.
Yeah, don't start on me.
I'm the best left tackle in the NFL. What the fuck are you doing yelling at me?
So we had to go to college.
And that's why he's successful. That's why Michigan's the top 10 team. It's because he just knows. Because after 4 years, they can just get out. And they're like, fuck that guy.
He's one of those guys, I can't stand him, but I feel like he's good for the fucking game. You know what I mean? I'm glad that he's there.
I love him. Because he's just so bad at being a human being and so great at being a football coach. And that's what's like when you watch all those interviews with Lombardi's wife.
Yeah.
And she's just like, well, you know, he was always at the facility. And you're like, yeah, that's a football coach. That guy was miserable. All he had was football. I kind of like that. Harbaugh's like, I used to play catch by myself. I'm like, good for you. fucking psycho.
What happened when he won the Super Bowl? Oh, probably 3-4 minutes of joy.
No, he didn't even win it. He lost it to his brother in perfect.
Oh, yeah. That's
Shakespearean.
And his brother, who seems like he's Apatow to me. You know what I mean? Like, he seems way fucking more comfortable.
He could own a local coffee shop. That's yeah. how likable his face is.
Dancer is in studio dance performing at Helium Comedy Club in Philly on Thursday, December 29th and Friday, December 30th. Go to heliumcomedy.com for tickets. And you can see Dan at Gotham Comedy Club in New York City on Friday, January 6th and Saturday, January 7th. Go to gothamcomedyclub.com for tickets.
Yeah. What are you doing for New Year's Eve?
I'm actually in Philly. I don't know. Yeah. Well, he omitted that.
Why would you omit the big New Year's Eve show?
And New Year's Eve.
That's
Philly.
His big that's the big show.
Oh, it was
show.
Just on a delay. It's
yeah,
okay.
I'm like, oh, they're cutting them out. Who are they bringing in that night?
It's me. Yeah. It's, disappointingly enough, it's still going to be me. No, I'm looking forward to it. I love Helium.
Of course you do.
It's the best. I did their secret show one time. It was fucking awesome.
What happens with the secret show? Am I not allowed to know?
They don't tell you who the headliner is until they walk out on stage. So on like a Wednesday night, and I was lucky because the secret headliner before me was Louis C.K.
Yeah.
So it was sold out within minutes of them releasing tickets. And then I walked on stage and I was like, woof, I'll give you 5 minutes to leave before you really hurt my ego.
Last week was Louis C.K. I wonder tonight.
I wonder if it's Chris Rock. Oh, I wonder who it's going to be. Maybe it'll be Chris D'Elia or Sebastian. No, it's just me.
Yeah, Chris D'Elia has an enormous career, huh?
He sells out like theater. Yeah. I mean, he did. What did he do this year for New York Comedy Festival? Beacon.
Wow,
it's fucking major.
And was all that based on that TV show?
No. He's been touring. Before. He's been touring a long time. Done a bunch of different TV shows. Yeah, he just built it.
Yeah,
built a
him.
Fan base. Yeah,
good for him.
I don't hate on anybody that built a fan base.
It's a tough thing to do when you have your own fans.
I'm telling you right now, there's a couple cities. Philadelphia is one of them.
Yeah,
where I don't have to apologize to waitresses because they're sent home early.
Well, you would be like, really thought that the second show was going to go, but
Austin, Texas, one time there was 16 people in the crowd, and it was a Saturday, and I heard a waitress audibly sigh. They're like, "You can go home. We're going to cut it down to 2." And she goes, "Ah, right." And then I look at it, and I'm like, "It's the end of the month."
Yeah, you're trying to like, well, let me know how SNL was.
Yeah. Oh, you're going to miss a new one that I'm going to do. Yeah. Oh, wait, you heard that on Thursday. Okay. Yeah, this is like not having a fan. You know, that was like three or four years ago. Mm. It just fucking sucks. You just feel so bad.
That's
the
way most people live, though. Most people
disappointed. I mean,
there's very few people, no matter what they do, that they're in that top 1% of their occupation.
Yeah, yeah. And I think
it's top 1% stuff.
Yeah, and you look at guys like Bill Burr, and you look at guys that have built it over time, and are, you know, these great like Norton and all that stuff, how they built their fan base, and you're like, all right, cool, you just got to stay in it.
And they're not happy, they're not satisfied. You look at somebody else, and they're like, ah, oh, fuck, that guy's life is better than mine.
That's what it always is that comparison, the devil of the comparison.
They say you're best to compare yourself to somebody who's doing really great and imagine it was easy for them. They say that's the best way to find happiness.
That's
I'll write that down.
Look at them. It's so easy for that guy over there.
Why can't it be easy for me? I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go online and talk shit to him.
I'm going to make up a new name and fucking tell him he's a hack.
What's one of my favorite comedies? I'm going to take a character from that and then add 69 to it and terrorize
him. That's good, though.
Yeah.
See, Vito looks at Chris Stanley like Chris has got it made.
Vito also looks like Chris Stanley's stunt double.
Well,
if you had Vito have to jump through a wall.
By double, does it even mean double the size?
No.
Yes. Say yes.
Okay. Yes. Yes. Yeah, for Chris's feelings. Yes, it's quadruple the size. I'm sorry, Vito. I don't mean to do this to you, but we're not in the same room.
If you guys wrestled, who would win, Vito?
Me. Chris has no fucking muscle whatsoever.
He has the strength over me. No, but I think I'm fucking crazy. I'll fight dirty.
Yeah, street smart.
Like, I will fucking fight dirty, and I'll fucking just... I think that's only my only chance against Vito.
Really?
He's seen me in the gym. He's seen me lift. I lift a lot of weight.
He's very strong.
Vito looks like he does strongman competitions. Like he does log tosses, and he's just picking up barrels of beer. Ah! I got, you know what, Chris, I got you, because I think that Astoria, Queens comes out, you go for a pipe like Ron was talking about.
Yeah, it's not going to be like a fucking fair fist fight. I'll get a weapon or something.
I feel like you got to move.
You think he can't get a weapon?
I think he has, he's like too, he's too good.
I'm
he's
from
too...
New York's Dangerous Upper West Side.
Yeah.
No, there's
you're
no
going to Postmate a weapon to you.
I would not stop short of getting a weapon, but I really, I have no doubt whatsoever that I could beat Chris in a wrestling match or just a straight street fight.
How do you think you would do here at SiriusXM if I went around and started fucking taking you studio to studio? Could we make some money doing this?
Yes. Like Lionheart.
Yeah.
I'd love to do that.
You know what? I'm sorry I called you an acting coach, because you do look like a low-level fight promoter.
First of all, low-level shooting high. But second, when, how are you guys going to feel when Vito's fucking eye is all busted up and his ears down and I'm still sending him out there? You've got it, kid.
That's my man, Dingo Vito. He fights everybody.
There's another $35 coming your way.
Rumor that Opie's got a kid, 305, Limba.
And then I'll be just like this. It's not your night, Vito. You're going to count the lights.
I got a deal going on with 80s on 8. You take a fall in the second.
Not to her. Anybody but to her.
Oh, man, that'd be so great if there was an underground fighting circuit. Serious out of that
I would
room.
Love it.
Oh, man.
I don't know if
there's I would have Jay. Here. I would promote Jay.
You think Jay could take down Vito?
Yeah. I feel Jay seasoned.
I've got youth on him, though.
Yeah, but you just have to out. You just have to hope till he's gassed.
I got news for you. If you're fighting Jay, I'm going to have to fucking jump on your back, Vito, and just start choking you with a chain.
he's grabbing the chain. Why are you doing this?
Like, I can take a lot of hits. Like, I've taken hits to the head before, and yeah. I won't go down. So I think that's my best advantage with Jay, because he's we match pretty well in size.
Yeah, no, tail of the tape, it lines up pretty good. I was thinking his first fight, your warm up fight should be Roland from Opie.
Oh, I hear Roland is a crazy man. I hear Roland fucking loses his shit if he has a problem. I've heard that from a couple people.
That would be great.
Just starts screaming in the street.
He has like a crazy temper, yeah.
Yeah. I've heard that time and time again.
Now I'm trying to size up everyone at Sirius to see what it would be. Like, who would fight out of what camp?
But the other thing I'd tell you about Roland is I guarantee you he's in a pair of shorts today, and he came that way from home. He wears his shorts in the winter, and he wears a t-shirt. He doesn't own a fucking coat.
Nope.
Wait, how does he get here?
He comes here by train, and he just fucking walks out in Long Island City, waits for the train, and the fucking sub-freezing in his gym shorts. No coat.
And gym t-shirt. Shorts. Yeah. Basketball shorts, too. Yeah, he wears basketball. Those. Yeah. Like those thin.
Mesh, like fucking basketball shorts.
Yeah, he's not wearing a nice, thick short.
Yeah, Vito. No, never mind, Vito. Don't take that first fight.
No, I could take anything. I'm really confident in myself on the SiriusXM Battle Royale.
It's not a battle royale, though. It's a one-on-one. It's
first of all,
style.
It's a battle royale. It's a fucking it's round unbelievable. Round. Just every fucking minute to see who's coming down the aisle. Yeah.
And just release it. Who is it? Who is it?
Like number 30 would be really exciting.
Yeah. To Sam like, Roberts.
I always think it's funny when it's half a team.
Yeah, it's down, great.
Like just one of the. You're like, you look like nothing by yourself.
Luke, where's Butch?
The best was Royal Rumble. I think 89 or 90, where number one was a member of Demolition and number two was a member. It was Axe and Smash.
And then they were just looking at each other.
They did the look and then they started fighting.
Yeah.
And then the third person came in and then they turned on them and you're like, that's just good wrestling writing right there.
Yeah. Well, they had to. I mean, the rules make them fight.
The Royal Rumble.
Yeah. You have to fight if you're in the ring.
The Royal Rumble.
I've been in one of those and it's fucking insane. Just everybody's count, the pop that every number gets, even if it's just some small jobber, is crazy.
I think I've said this before. It's my favorite pay-per-view to watch and gamble on. If people over, you pay for a number, you get that number, you get that wrestler. You just hope he wins Royal Rumble.
It's very exciting, and it's very exciting when you figure out somebody's been in there for a long time, too. Yeah. And you're like, holy shit. I just thought Flair's still in there.
It's like 25 minutes now. He's just in the corner, just fucking winded.
Just
he's in there.
Sitting on the third turnbuckle.
Yeah. Holding onto the bottom rope, and fucking getting kicked.
The other great thing is when it would take 20 guys to throw one guy over.
Yeah, Andre.
Yeah, Andre would.
Guys, let go. Guys, let go. Like if he was really freaked out. Guys, don't grab my. No. Let go of my leg. Let go. He never fell gracefully. He always came over, but then surprisingly landed on his feet.
You ever meet Andre or be close to him?
No way. He
giant warts.
Kid.
Giant warts all over him.
On his, you could see in some picture on his
eyes. Eyes reach. Down his thighs and stuff like that. And it was really strange to see. I mean, like, this can be burned off.
Yeah, do you think, how long do you think it would take to burn off all the warts on Andre the Giant?
Oh, they were like Christmas balls. They were
oh, like, Christ.
I mean, they were the size of Christmas balls.
And they were everywhere.
I wouldn't say everywhere, but they were in a couple different places.
You can see in older pictures of him, he's got them on his face.
They might have been just skin tags, a giant skin tag.
Well, maybe it's because he's grown, like, you know, his cells are so used to growing so fast that his skin just keeps growing.
Yeah, he just couldn't keep up with it.
Yeah.
How old was he when he died? Was he in his 40s?
I think so.
Because he had been around since he was like 18. Like, those initial things for him, he came over as a child in this country.
Yeah, and he was young in the WWWF.
He was only 46.
Yeah.
Wow.
And he'd probably been around for at least 26 years. Like, he was around in the regional times. Like, he would,
The great story about him getting signed to the, like, Vince McMahon's dad signing him, and it was like 27 bottles of wine.
Yeah.
Like, that's how many he drank.
Yeah, that's what took him to get drunk.
Jesus.
Like a fucking keg of wine.
Did you ever hear that fucking story when he was doing that, Princess Bride movie, and he had to be on a horse, and they had to fucking lower him down off this like crane into a horse, and he was all drunk. He was just drunk off his ass, and they were lowering him down.
I'm going to break this horse. I'm hammered. Hey, let me fight the horse. I want to fight him later.
I also heard no one touched their wallet when he was around. He paid for everything. And any time he went out.
That's pretty awesome. Yeah, Hulk Hogan told a great story on this interview about him and Andre being in Japan together, and they checked into their hotel, and then Andre called Hogan and was like, hey, boss, come up here. Look at this. And he went upstairs, and Andre the Giant laid out newspapers and took a shit just on the floor, and he just thought it was funny. And I was like, he's a giant child. He's just a giant drunk child. This guy was awesome.
How Ari Shaffir of him to do that. Just,
yeah, Ari bit that move off of Andre the Giant.
I'm telling you that I was there the night that the box was opened.
Were you there when the box was opened?
Yeah.
You were in the...
Yes.
Mike Vecchione described it as a faint smell filled the room.
Well, faint would be too kind of a word. It was the worst thing I ever smelled in my life. It cleared out. But the weird thing is people started panicking and running and shit. And I looked back over my shoulder and Ari was laughing. Tears were coming out of his eyes, laughing like a school shooter.
It's
like it was.
It's one of the best videos. It's online. You can see Ari is enjoying himself. It's such villain as something burns and they're just like the cackle. It's great.
I will also say that there may be something seriously wrong with his digestive system because it was a string cheese shit that I saw there. Oh. It was just a...
Oh, it wasn't a log.
No, not a mannish log.
Thin and sick.
He was thin, but endless, you know?
Jesus.
Yeah, well, he's notoriously got a pretty gross butthole.
Yeah.
So I don't think...
It's an Audi.
The thing I'm impressed with... Is that he shit in a box? Because I've shit in a bag before,
okay,
but I've never shit in a box. And I feel like that's, do you hold it? Do you put it down?
Well, I think he explained it later that he was kind of crouched over it in a, it's just an alarming way, you know?
Yeah.
Now, somebody's written to us and said that you went outside recently and saw Chris Stanley smoking.
Bullshit.
What at?
It was outside the Gas Digital Network party.
Were you not smoking?
That was Ray Kump smoking.
Okay.
Tim Dillon's co-host.
All right.
No way was I smoking a cigarette. And then.
And you know what? I'll tell you this. I was very high and I just went outside and I just always assumed you smoked. And then someone tweeted that at me and I'm like, oh, I don't want to get him in trouble.
No, if I was.
Who would he be in trouble with? All of his parents
himself.
Are dead.
Well, you know. Maybe they're looking over
him. Secret.
Where did they have the big Gas Digital party at?
At Dream Baby down on the Lower East Side, Alphabet City.
They're handing out edibles, and I just had too many. And I wanted to talk about Westworld. And Chris was there for me.
It was right before the ending of the show, the finale.
Yeah. Were you happy with the finale?
Yeah. Mm. I liked it. I shit's judged too harshly these days. They do all these cool shows and people are like, it wasn't, the execution wasn't, they're all tiger moms when it comes to our, when it comes to TV.
We expect so much.
Yeah. There were some glaring holes that I wish they would have, you know, probably filled in, but I thought the finale was really good. I watched it twice.
I just think that you don't understand what it's like to now have to tell this story for 10 hours instead of 2 hours. You know what I mean? Like, you're going to repeat some stuff and have some weird shit because it's 10 hours now.
And you have to, like, basically have seven different stories going.
Right. And then they all have to come together at the right moment and make sense, or else everyone's furious at you.
And you're going to blog and be like, fire him.
Right.
Like, there's so much, you know, pressure on that.
And like, everyone thinks that there's somehow talent for figuring out where the show's going. Why don't you just fucking watch the show?
Yeah.
Who cares whether you're the
one? I will say this, though. I had a friend that had a theory about Westworld, and he was right.
Which one?
That shit that Bernard was a host.
Yeah, everybody knew that.
Well, I am dumb.
Yeah.
And I was blown away by it. I was like a caveman seeing fire. I was like, robot, but he's main guy.
I'm not even sure if anyone's not a robot. Now, here's the question no one's asking. Where is this even taking place?
That's
how do we even know if it's Earth?
That's the question that, oh man, yeah, I can go deep on this. I love all that shit.
But it won't be out until 2018. That's how long we got to wait. This entire year, we're not going to see Westworld.
Good. I like that because that means they're working hard on it.
It doesn't necessarily mean, it might be mean they're negotiating for more money. Who knows what it's going to take?
Getting real.
Any more robots?
What are we watching in January? Is anything big starting?
February, Billions.
I can't wait for that. Give me an inside hint.
Done.
Are they going to be fighting back and forth?
Yes.
Is it law versus money?
Yes.
Okay, good.
I hope I didn't spoil anything. It's actually a fucking great season.
Are you happy with it?
Yeah. I just wrapped 2 days ago.
Great.
And it was, it's going to be cool.
You have no intimidation about being on a big set like that? No.
1,000% I do. I have no business being there. I'm a fucking clown. And when they're on, like, there was an episode where I was just like, we were filming and I was just staying there with Maggie Siff and Damian Lewis. And I'm like, what am I doing?
Damian Lewis is a physically intimidating dude.
He is the best human being.
Yeah.
I fucking love working with that guy. Him, David Costable. I mean, the entire cast is great, but those two are those are the two big guys, you know, Damian Lewis and David Costable, and they're both just fucking great human beings.
It's great, man.
Yeah, and it makes it easy to work with. And then you watch them act, and you're like, oh, wow, you're fucking good.
Right. You can lie a lot easier than I can.
Yeah.
You're lying to everyone.
Oh, my. How do you lie like that? That'd be great after a take. And cut. How are you lying like that? God damn, you're a great liar.
And then if they're just going like this, see this giant house? It's my real house that I live in. Those are my real cars over there.
I think I ate something weird and my stomach hurts.
It's acting.
That was that John Lovitz character that I loved on Ass.
Acting!
Acting!
That's when he peaked. That was...
Yeah.
People forget that John Lovitz was a guy who saved SNL, and it never gets credit for it.
I was too young to realize...
But that show would have been
canceled. Without John Lovitz?
Yeah.
I was too young to realize he saved it. I just liked him. I liked him and The Liar. Yeah, that's the ticket.
He was the only star that they had that season, and they were talking about fucking ending the show constantly. But no. Said Mr. Lovitz, I will put this show on my back like JFK did with that drowning Navy guy and swim in to the island, even hurting my own back. Later, being shot by an assassin's bullet.
Yo, John.
I like that you saw it all the way through.
Yeah, I'm going to stay with it. I'm not going to give up on it. All right, we got to wrap this up. Hope's coming in.
Yes. Dancer has been in studio dance performing at Helium Comedy Club in Philly and through... Thursday, December 9th through Saturday, December 31st, go to heliumcomedy.com for tickets. And you can see Dan at Gotham Comedy Club in New York City on Friday, January 6th and Saturday, January 7th. Go to gothamcomedyclub.com for tickets. On Twitter, it's at Dan Soder.
You sounded like kind of sad and, you know, somewhat even during that. It's exciting news that you're laying out, Chris.
I was just trying to speak slowly so everyone got
the
information.
Bringing in the new year in Philadelphia. Much like the Mummers do every January 1.
Yeah, and I'm going to take off before the Mummers thing.
You're insane. Stay for it.
I might stay. You know what? I might stay. I could be convinced into staying. And, Chris, I just want to say, I apologize that I remembered wrong, and it was Ray Kump smoking and not you.
Thank you, Dan Soder.
You know what, Smokey? You might have got around this time, but I know you're up to something, and I'm going to find out exactly what it is. Tobacco breath. Who would you hide it from?
I don't know.
No one left.
If I was smoking it,
I don't care if you're shooting fucking dope down in the Lower East Side. That gas works taking off for themselves, huh?
They're doing well.
I got to say this. Maybe the guy who's turning it all around for himself is that Luis J. Gomez. He is going to be the guy we all call in the future.
You know what my new nickname for him is 2017 is? Pinocchio, because now he's a real boy.